It's Tuesday, the 19th of April, 2016. Jumbo Africa. This is Newsroom on SABC News, Channel 404. A very warm welcome as we broadcast live from our Auckland Park studios here in Johannesburg, South Africa, to the rest of the African continent. I'm Elvis Preslin. I'll be with you until 12 o'clock. We're also streaming live on YouTube with the entire show now available on our YouTube channel. Now today we focus on the Truth and Reconciliation Commission, which marks 20 years since the first public hearings of South Africa's Truth and Reconciliation Commission. And many believe that a lot of work still needs to be done, as some of the atrocities committed during apartheid remains unresolved. So our question of the day is, do you think there's a need for a second Truth and Reconciliation Commission? I want to get your thoughts on the Facebook page as well as on the Twitter handle at SABC Newsroom. Let us know and I'll read your comments a little bit later. But first, let's take a look at your headlines with Kendall Macomate.
Topping our stories, President Jacob Zuma leads a high-level government delegation for a round of talks relating to the Southern African Customs Union. Bodies of the victims of the weekend bus crash in which ANC volunteers were involved will be taken to the Germiston mortuary. An emergency rescue personnel in Ecuador rejoice after saving two survivors from rubble caused by a massive earthquake that left over 410 people dead. And of course, coming up in your sports a little later today.
For the laureates, World Sportsman of the Year is Novak Djokovic.
And the world of tennis celebrated as Novak Djokovic and Serena Williams named the Sportswoman and Sportsman of the Year at the annual Laureus World Sports Awards.
And the Swiss stars got it. Who wins it?
And South Africa's wheelchair marathon ace Ernst van Dijk beaten into second place by Swiss Marcel Hug for the second time in a row at the Boston Marathon. All this as former Pakistan captain Inzamam Ul Haq gets the nod to take over as his country's chief selector. And that's what we have in the sports a little later on, but now to the news. And our top story that we start the bulletin with is the bodies of the 10 victims of the weekend bus crash in the Free State will be taken to the Germiston mortuary today. They were returning to Gauteng after attending the ANC local election manifesto launch in Port Elizabeth this past weekend. Meanwhile, police say that two bus drivers will be charged with culpable homicide after they allegedly changed seats while the vehicle was in motion.
Naledi Sithole was supposed to celebrate his 10th birthday, but instead, he's mourning the death of his mother, Gugu Sithole. She was one of the ANC volunteers who died in a bus crash in the early hours of Sunday.
We have mixed emotions. It's more of if only she didn't go, what went wrong?
Sithole died together with 10 others when the bus they were traveling in crashed between Windberg and Venterberg in the Free State. The Gauteng ANC visited six of the families.
We are devastated by this loss, and we wish we could have done things differently. These comrades who are departed are our volunteers.
For these survivors, though, it was a narrow escape. They were sleeping, but only to wake up on the side of the road. Those who witnessed the crash alleged that the drivers were trying to swap seats while the bus was in motion.
While we were traveling, we saw the two drivers exchanging seats just a few seconds before the accident. Then we later found ourselves lying on the side of the road.
An investigation is underway to determine the cause of the accident, while the bus company has also launched its own investigation. Ndlandlatlani, SABC News.
Now we now cross live to our reporter Ishmael Mudiba, who's in Bloemfontein at the state mortuary, where all the post-mortems and Sunday's bus crash victims have been completed. We understand that the bodies of the deceased have just left the Bloemfontein State Mortuary back home to Gauteng, where the process of identification is expected to start. Now, let's see if we can get in touch with Ishmael. Ishmael, good morning, and can you give us an update, please, on what's happening with the transportation of the bodies?
Good morning, Elvis. Yes, we are here at the Bloemfontein State Mortuary, where the bodies, the 10 bodies have just left the premises about 25 minutes ago. The two transport carrying the corpses left the building under a heavy security, with the MEC for road transport and safety accompanying the body to Germiston in Gauteng, where the family of the deceased will converge at the mortuary in Gauteng in Germiston, where they'll do the actual body identification. Earlier on, we spoke to the MEC, MEC Butana Kompela, who passed a message of condolences and said he was shocked to learn that to hear of the allegation that apparently these drivers were indeed allegation that they were changing seat. He says it's something that he has never heard of, and up until yesterday he received a lot of calls from many people around the province saying we know about this trend that is happening, and for us it's not a new thing. But for the MEC, he says he's utterly shocked by what he heard, and he says speaking on the incident, he said the law should not the two alleged drivers should not be charged with culpable homicide, but he said this case should be turned into a murder. He says it's an head off, and the law should be harsh on this particular incident.
Lots to look into in terms of the cause of that particular accident itself. Could you tell us, in terms of the families of the deceased, were they present at the mortuary, and what kind of reactions did you get from them?
Well, unfortunately, when we arrived here, it was only the officials from the government mortuary and the government at the MEC and his entourage. So it was only the people who are involved in the actually dealing with the work here. So there were no families to speak to. So it was only the government officials and the MEC that we managed to speak to.
Right. Now, can you tell us, in terms of what else is expected to happen today at that particular location, is there anything that we can share with our viewers?
Well, from where we are, like I said, the body have left the premises, and it's only the only thing that is left is for when the body arrive in Germiston, for the families to come and then identify the body so that the necessary arrangement can be made for the funeral. And we're not sure, because yesterday we heard that they were talking about, there was a suggestion of a mass funeral, something that the ANC in Gauteng still have to sit down and discuss and see with the family how they are going to work out with about this horrific incident. So we'll see as of from today and as the week progresses, how the whole funeral arrangement is going to be arranged.
Right. Now, Ishmael, thank you so much for bringing us that news, and we do hope that this gets put to bed soon with all the information that we need. That was a reporter, Ishmael Mudiba, reporting from the State Mortuary in Bloemfontein. Now, on to other news. We've got Radovan Kretsch's application to appeal his 35-year sentence continuing in the South Gauteng High Court today. Now, Kretcher and five others are seeking leave to appeal their conviction and sentences for attempted murder, kidnapping and drug dealing. His legal counsel yesterday argued that the accused were convicted in sentences of charges of drug dealing, despite the fact that the drugs were never identified by an expert. We now cross to our reporter, Gillian Pillay, who's at the South Gauteng High Court, to give us more on this particular story. Gillian, good morning. And can you tell us what exactly can you update us with there?
A very good morning to you. Yes, what we expect from today's proceedings, if that's what you're asking, because I'm having difficulty hearing you, is that teams here will wrap up their submissions. Yesterday we saw the prosecution ending with its submissions, and this will give teams an opportunity now to respond to the submissions put forward by the prosecution. Whether or not today will be the last day of submissions is unclear. This appeal has been set down for 4 days, which is expected to end on Thursday. We also expect one of the accused to put in a special entry around evidence that they want to have admitted for this particular appeal.
Gillian, does that cover everything that happened on day one, or are there specific instances that you'd like to bring to our attention?
I'm really having difficulty hearing you. But just to give you a sense of what transpired yesterday in court, we saw a lot of being spoken about the intent to deal in drugs being... What the defense was actually pointing out was that the state failed to prove that the substance was actually crystal meth. And in the South African, under South African law, if you in dealing in an unknown substance, you can't be sentenced or convicted for that. The state also pointed to reasons put forward by the court around that they didn't prove beyond reasonable doubt that, for example, Kretcher was the mastermind. They also pointed out inconsistencies by witnesses. And those were the kinds of submissions that we saw playing out here in court. Today, we expect them to wrap up with submissions, but it'll also give the defense an opportunity to respond to submissions made by the prosecution.
Gillian, thank you so much for that. Our reporter there, Gillian Pile, doing very well under duress, not really hearing what we're saying here, out of the South Gauteng High Court, where the Kretcher case has been heard. Now, I will now hand over back to Elvis, who's got more news for you.
Thank you, Kendall. And of course, we're asking you a very important question today. We're reflecting on the Truth and Reconciliation Commission many years ago. And the question that we pose to you, is there a need for a second TRC? Now, the Institute for Justice and Reconciliation will hold public hearings this month, we believe, the debates to mark the 20th anniversary of the commencement of the Truth and Reconciliation Commission, the TRC, in South Africa. And we'd like to get your thoughts on the particular question on the Facebook page as well as on the Twitter handle. I'd like to get your thoughts on that and the question that we pose to you. Do you believe that we need a second TRC? Now, the Institute for Justice and Reconciliation will hold public debates to mark the 20th anniversary of the commencement of the Truth and Reconciliation Commission, the TRC, here in South Africa. The public dialogue, reconciliation and betrayal is the first public event in the series to commemorate the TRC. The objective is to locate the current debate on reconciliation and its trajectory since 1994. But 20 years later, since the first sitting of the commission, hundreds of political crimes, including murder, kidnapping and torture, remain unpunished, resulting in a blame game. The commission's first public hearing on April the 15th, 1996, that's 2 years after the end of white minority rule, was a solemn affair, met with both hope and apprehension. The Institute for Justice and Reconciliation's Executive Director, Dr. Fani de Toit, now joins us from our Pretoria studios. Doctor, very good morning to you and welcome.
Good morning.
Now, Doctor, as we reflect on the 20 years since the first sitting of the TRC in East London, I want you to take us back to your recollections of the event at that particular time.
Yes, it was a historic milestone. There's no doubt about the significance of that day, when the first hearings kicked off in East London in the Eastern Cape, and the apartheid era victims were given center stage with the limelight of the world, not just South African media, but the world media on them, given the opportunity to debunk one of the oldest myths in South Africa, namely that white rule and that apartheid was beneficial to this country, and that it was a kind of benign development project. In fact, what these victims did was to show us the brutal underbelly of apartheid and evoke in the whole nation a kind of a moment of silence to listen what these people, these brave individuals, were telling us.
Talk to us about those emotions and what went through you as the commission that was sitting there to hear these horrific stories that came through. How did you feel?
Yes, I mean, I just have to say I was not a member of the commission at the time. I was an interested member of the public. Mm-hmm. But it was very clear to everybody observing this that this commission would take on its own life. Bear in mind that at that point, nothing like this had been done anywhere in the world ever before. So we were inventing as we were going on. And the first thing that happened was that we realized that these victim narratives, the stories of these people, were going to change the public discourse in South Africa forever. And when we actually then went back to the public in the year 2000, 2001, to measure public opinion, we could see the shifts in public opinion as a result of what these victims told us during these hearings.
Did it change that discourse, Doctor? And are you of the view that the TRC did achieve its objectives?
You know, I think the TRC is often misunderstood and misremembered as well. We kind of look to the TRC now, Elvis, as a sort of one-stop shop to have solved all our problems. And quite clearly, no commission could have achieved that. What the commission was tasked to do, and what I think it did achieve, was to highlight and foreground the stories of those people that suffered most under apartheid. And that created a consensus in South Africa, amongst white and black South Africans, that apartheid was in fact a crime against humanity, that we could not go back to any form of racial discrimination, and that moving forward was our only option. Now, if you go to any conflict zone across the world, that sort of consensus is missing. South Africa was able to create it through the work of the TRC. That, in my view, was the big achievement. Yes, it had many failures too. I think it did not focus enough on gender and gender crimes and the fact that women bear a disproportionate brunt of the apartheid violence. It did not focus enough also on the structural dimension, the trauma of poverty, the trauma of forced removals, the trauma of just being black in South Africa, as we have heard since. So these are gaps in what the TRC did. But the core task of unearthing the atrocities, the political crimes of apartheid, the TRC did to some measure. Mm-hmm. If, however, I would submit, if the Gender Commission and the Land Commission and the RDP Commission, all these other commissions also performed to the level of the TRC, we may have had a very different debate today.
Are you suggesting then that implementation was not at the core of this exercise?
I think the implementation was fine until the commission closed its doors, but then the recommendations that were handed over to government was followed up, shall we say, at best with a lackluster commitment. And therefore today, the big omission of the TRC is not what it did during the 18 months of its life, but what happened or failed to happen since. So if you ask the question, should we have a second TRC, how can we if we haven't even implemented the first one yet properly? And so the question around reparations for victims, the South African Coalition of Transitional Justice has been campaigning for this for a very long time, 10 years in fact, and we are only now beginning to get a signal that a government is in fact willing to take this seriously and to sit down with communities to see what community reconciliation would look like. Similarly to prosecutions, I believe there should have been more prosecutions of those people who either snubbed the process or failed to gain amnesty during the process. In fact, 200 to 300 names were handed to government. Only less than a handful of cases have been taken up. So, you know, the implementation has been poor, and I think that is where we are today re-evaluating the legacy, and that's why your pertinent question is also born.
Mm-hmm. Now, I was going to ask you that question because it is a pertinent one in terms of the second TRC, but Africa and the rest of the world envy what we have done here with the TRC. But in retrospection, if we can look at that, have South Africans, have we not become our very own worst enemies by criticizing our own very good efforts by the TRC?
I think we are not very good historians when we talk about the TRC. You see, the TRC dealt with memory of apartheid, but now the TRC itself has become memory. And the way we remember the TRC is not very accurate. So we blame the TRC for all the failures of modern-day South Africa, and we all know those failures. We could list them. However, I don't think that's fair to focus that on one commission. That commission's job was to unearth the hidden atrocities of apartheid, and it did a good job in that. What it failed to do, I've already said. So it wasn't perfect, but it did a very good job at what it was mandated to do. So now, yes, I think sometimes South Africans are overly critical, but at the same time, I just want to say I think what have happened subsequent to the TRC have been poor,
yes,
and we are right to criticize that side of it.
Now, Doctor, the Institute for Justice and Reconciliation will be holding public debates. What would you like to see come out of those debates?
I'd like to see a more nuanced remembering of the TRC. I'd like to see us evaluate the actual legacy and achievements of the TRC more accurately, and then say, now, is it that the TRC let us down? Or is it in fact that we have let the TRC down by not following up on this commission adequately? So for me, I'd like to see also a sense of, if you ask, should there be another TRC, perhaps there should be more seriousness about implementation of the first TRC recommendations. If some of that resolve emerged from these conversations, I'd be more than happy.
Doctor, thank you so much for joining us. That was the Institute for Justice and Reconciliation's Executive Director, Dr. Fani du Toit, in our Pretoria studios. Now, as we talk about this, we're also asking you that very pivotal question this morning that relate to the TRC. We're asking you, should there be a second one? He answered the question, but I would like to know from you, what do you make of it? Do you think that we need a second Truth and Reconciliation Commission? Let us know on the Facebook page. If you like us there, by the way, you become part and parcel of the informed here on Newsroom. You can also let us know on the Twitter handle at SABC Newsroom. This year marks 20 years since the first public hearings of South Africa's Truth and Reconciliation Commission. That commission was set up by government, the government of national unity at the point in time, to help deal with what happened under apartheid. And the hearings made international news, and many sessions were broadcast on national television. Now, the South African History Archives believes a lot of work still needs to be done, as some of the atrocities committed during the apartheid era remains unresolved. To further the discussion on the 20 years anniversary of the TRC, we're joined in studio by one of the South African History Archives trustees, Piers Pigo. I hope I pronounced that correct.
That's correct. Thank you.
Very good morning to you and welcome.
Morning.
Now, we heard there from the good doctor that, the question that we should actually ask is, have we let the TRC down? What do you think about that?
Well, I think there's an enormous amount of unfinished business from the Truth Commission process. And as Dr. du Toit mentioned, there's a template of recommendations that the Commission made which provide a framework for engagement. And if one assesses the progress made on that framework, there's some positives, but largely there's deficits. There's an enormous amount of work that still could be done. And that, I think, would feed probably into your earlier question about a second TRC. It's really more about how one builds and scaffolds on the foundational framework that the original TRC provided. It certainly had lots of failures to it and limitations to it, but there's a lot more that could be done around the core objectives that feed into the broader reconciliation narrative that is at the center of this debate.
Talk to me about those limitations and failures that you mentioned and the deficit that the TRC had.
Well, I think on the first instance, I mean, the Commission was given this enormous task of trying to understand the context, and the mechanics of the violations of the past, the motivations, the consequences, and so forth. This was always going to be a tall order in terms of the limited temporal time period that the Commission had to engage in, the raw materials that it had there. As I said, it provided a framework on that front, and as Dr. du Toit was saying, made some important breakthroughs in terms of understanding the nature of those violations, but much more could have been done on the truth recovery front. What we ended up with in the TRC was a meta-narrative of the big story of South Africa, populated by lots of individual
case stories. But many of those were not told and captured. And of course, what we haven't got across the country are community narratives of the histories of these places. So there's lots and lots of gaps in the storytelling to be done, but there's other areas around reparations and so forth, which Dr. Toy mentioned also. From the South African History Archives point of view, one of our major concerns is about records, documentation, the actual archive of the Truth Commission is sitting unprocessed in Pretoria for the last 13, 14 years. Mm-hmm. It's largely inaccessible. The South African History Archive has had to use access to information legislation to try and access documentation, which was, in some instances, already in the public domain.
Which is public knowledge.
Yes.
But why was that, and why they make it so difficult for you to access these documentation that you need?
Well, the mechanics of processing, mm-hmm. arranging and describing and setting out the Truth Commission archive is an expensive and time-consuming process. Mm-hmm. But it requires prioritization by National Archives to do that. It's been in the planning for some time, but there's a lack of political prioritization and commitment mm-hmm. to making this real.
Mm-hmm. Now, we understand that you were also a TRC investigator. What are some of the things that you uncovered about the TRC which the general public might not know?
Well, there's many things, of course, that didn't get into the public reporting of the Commission. Mm-hmm. And I should just add that it's important for viewers to understand that the vast majority of South Africans have never seen the Truth Commission report, have never seen the recommendations that were made to it. Now, it is available online, mm-hmm. but the popular version of the report was never produced mm-hmm. and distributed. And so most South Africans remain in the dark. When it comes to individual cases, I was involved in a range of cases, some high profile, some less so. Mm-hmm. What that showed me was the limitations of what the Commission could do in terms of forensic investigations, but mm-hmm. what it also showed was the possibility of shining the light on numerous cases that could provide victims, families, survivors and so forth with more information about the context, the reasons, the causes behind the violations that they suffered.
Pierre, it seems like we need a whole day to talk about this, but talk to me now about some of the activities that you have planned to mark the commemorate the 20 years of the TRC.
Well, SAHA has relaunched an exhibition at Constitution Hill, which is about memory against forgetting. We have a exhibition that we've done with the Cape Town-based Human Rights Media Centre with the Kulamani Support Group Western Cape branch. Mm-hmm. And so we would urge people to go and have a look at that exhibition, which is up until the end of, I think, the first week of May. Mm-hmm. We have a screening of a video relating to the Rwandan process mm-hmm. Taking place on Thursday mm-hmm. This week. And SAHA is continuing. This is, while we're commemorating the 20 years, this is work that we carry on a daily, weekly, monthly basis mm-hmm. in terms of interrogating the archive, trying to preserve the past, and trying to make that archive available to the broader South African public. Mm-hmm.
For many of people that don't know, you were referring to the Rwandan process, they don't know that that process was born out of the Truth and Reconciliation Commission here in South Africa.
Well, in some mm-hmm. respects, there is the connection. And I think the major contribution that the public hearing process that we're commemorating this week shows was South Africa was the first truth recovery process mm-hmm. that engaged in a public hearing process. Mm-hmm. We'd seen truth commissions before that on this continent and elsewhere in Latin America, but they'd been private, in-camera, secretive processes. This one splashed it out in front mm-hmm. of the entire world. And this fed into a process in Rwanda, the Gacaca process, in terms of a public hearing process around perpetrators. It was a very different process to us, but certainly there was a connection, and South Africa has been a critical catalyst for public engagement and ensuring that the public and the victims and the survivors remain at the center of these processes.
We've run completely out of time, but I need to ask you this question. Your view on a second TRC?
Well, I think it's an enormous amount that could be done within a refined commission-type process. But we certainly don't need a replica of what happened before. Mm-hmm. We can build on some of the strengths of what happened before. So, yes, a lot more work can and should be done.
Mm-hmm. Piers, thank you so much for joining us here in studio.
Thank you.
That was Piers Pigo. He is from the South African History Archives. He's a trustee there joining us in studio. We'll continue that discussion and would like to get your thoughts on the matter. We're asking you the question, what do you think? Should there be a second TRC? Let me know on the Facebook page as well as on the Twitter handle at SABC Newsroom. Let's take a look at some of your comments, and staying with today's theme, remember that we ask you that all-important question. Is there a need for that second TRC? All your comments on the Facebook page. There is some of the visuals that you've seen from the Truth and Reconciliation Commission. Look at the arch, devastated there, crying at the hearings. Those are some of the pictures dating back almost 20 years now. Let's take a look at your comments. Comment of the day, which was sent to us by Roy Africa. Alan Gray welcomes Nene with open arms. So let's take a look at that. That's a tweet of the day there. Mr. Will Alan Gray welcomes Nene with open arms at Destiny Man. Now, you know the story, of course. The minister, ex-finance minister Nene, that was fired, supposed to join a bank, or the BRICS bank. Never happened, and he's now with Alan Gray. That is the picture. The man says, I'm getting paper. There you have it on the screen. Nene is a happy at Alan Gray, at one from Sibandla Sabahle, joining us there on the Twitter handle. Yes, working with paper. Look at me now. I'm getting paper. I wonder which sort of paper. Is it green paper, perhaps, you think? Well, we'll have to find out. Let's take a look at what's happening in the news today, right here on our in South Africa. Czech fugitive in the courts, Radovan Krejcer and five co-defendants, their application for leave to appeal will resume in the High Court in Johannesburg today. We'll cross there a little bit later to find out what is the latest. As you recall, in February, the six men were sentenced on charges ranging from attempted murder, kidnapping and drug dealing. Krejcer was sentenced to 35 years in prison. The bodies of at least 10 people who died when a bus crashed outside Windberg in the Free State at the weekend will be taken to Germiston mortuary today. That's our second story. The victims were returning to the East Rand after they attended the ANC local election manifesto launch in Port Elizabeth over the weekend. And then police say the two bus drivers will be charged with culpable homicide. On to Gauteng now. The Gauteng Department of Education's online learner admission campaign will face its real test today, as thousands of parents are expected to apply for spaces for their children for next year. The online application drive for grades 1 and 8 is aimed at ensuring that all pupils are placed on time. Last week, the department suspended the pre-registration phase after the system crashed. Well, there you have it. That's local news right here on our doorstep. Let's take a look at the front pages of the newspapers from around the globe to get you updated there. We'll start off in Europe. The Times report that Muslim chaplains appointed by the Ministry of Justice routinely distribute Islamist hate literature in British prisons. A leaked report is found. As you can see, the imams are allowed to preach hate in prison. That's the front page there of the Times. Let's now move to New York. The Financial Times says that Brazil's currency reversed big gains from Congress voting to impeach the president, Dilma Rousseff, and sank lower yesterday after the country's central bank intervened to prevent the real appreciating too steeply against the dollar, as you can see the front page there. And then finally, in Israel, the Jerusalem Post reports that a bomb exploded at the back of a bus and injured 21 people as it traveled through southeast Jerusalem yesterday. Those are all your newspapers, the front pages of some of the papers around the globe. We'll take a short break and we'll be right back after that. You have to stay tuned. This is your favorite channel, Newsroom.
Afternoon, you're watching the Midday Report.
Lunchtime news amplified.
But for now, this is what they call home. Their hope to shift to higher ground seems to be against the tide.
Midday Report provides you with more than just news stories.
I just want Port Elizabeth to know that they own a world-class theatre.
Good afternoon, you're with the news at one in the headlines.
Very good afternoon to you. This is News Live. I'm Natasha Thorpe. Let's take a quick look at what's coming up in your headlines.
Good afternoon and welcome to A View from the House.
For all things news, tune in to Midday Report weekdays at 12 noon only on the SABC News Channel.
Now, we continue with our theme of the day, which is the 20th anniversary since the start of the TRC hearings. We're asking you that question, of course. Is there a need for a second TRC? Two decades down the line, most of the UPLA political prisoners, a military wing belonging to the Pan-Africanist Congress, the PAC, who were detained in the 80s while fighting against the apartheid government, are still languishing in jail. The PAC is now heading a campaign on free UPLA prisoners, calling for the release of the imprisoned members. And to discuss this, we're now joined by the PAC Secretary General, Narius Moloto. Mr. Moloto, very good morning to you and welcome.
Thank you very much.
First and foremostly, it's now been 20 years since the TRC hearings. As the PAC, what is your take on the role of the Commission, and do you think that it has achieved its objective?
Look, the PAC from the onset and from the record of TRC itself, which are here, it shows clearly that we're not happy with its work from the onset, in terms of reference, because we do not believe that the freedom fighters should be kept in prison, particularly by the democratic government.
Why is that?
We don't know. Mm-hmm. We've been asking those in authority, particularly because the definition of a political prisoner was very simple and clear, mm-hmm. that are those people who were acting under the instructions of political liberation movements, in our case. Mm-hmm.
Now, you have concerns that the Truth and Reconciliation gave amnesty to others and not to the PAC UPLA force members. Have you got more information around that, and why would that be the case? Do you think it's a political agenda, perhaps?
Look, we do have information. As early as 1995, in January, we submitted a list, and I have copies of all this list, to the then Minister of Justice, Tola Omar, at that time.
Okay.
And where we indicated that this number of political prisoners, prisoners are still in detained and for activities of the UPLA and PAC, mm-hmm. and that they shouldn't be there. Mm-hmm. He acknowledged the list and gave it to the Truth and Reconciliation. And up until today, because no answers are coming, and this issue is purely political, we do not think that there's justification to hold political prisoners. Mm-hmm. Most of them are there longer than the democratic government itself.
Sure.
Now, therefore, we do not think that there's justice. Mm-hmm. Our understanding of Truth and Reconciliation, one was that truth should be told,
yes.
As is, and also that reconciliation must arise out of the truth. And this is what has not been forthcoming. Mm-hmm. Now, we believed as PAC that we should have a new chapter after the Truth and Reconciliation Commission. Mm-hmm. And that was never the case. Mm-hmm. And here we are, in case of PAC, we're only isolating, talking Truth and Reconciliation on a very narrow and isolated basis, for instance, the issue of political prisoners. Mm. But there's a whole range of brutality that happened as early as 60s, where members of Porto Apla were executed. Mm-hmm. Most of those members were picked up and were simply just hanged without being associated with any sort of operation. There are a lot of injustice. We have many people that are missing. Up until now, they have not been accounted for. Mm-hmm. Now, those areas, insofar as PAC and UPLA is concerned, those cases remain unresolved. Mm-hmm. So the pain in society, the pain mm-hmm. in families, is still continuing, still there. Therefore, in our books as PAC, we do not think that, I think half-truth, if any, mm-hmm. was told. Mm-hmm. And the question is that what about the whole truth? Mm-hmm. Do we know the truth? And is justice happened? Mm-hmm. Did we really do justice to ourselves as society and as community, particularly to the those sons and daughters? Mm-hmm. of this soil that went and sacrificed their lives to mm-hmm. go and fight for the liberation of this country.
Would you say that this is justice delayed, really, for the PAC members that have been languishing?
It's miscarriage of justice. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. We do not really think that as a society will make progress because you have people that you have so many suffering mm-hmm. families parents. Who people who could able to come and contribute and develop and take them forward mm-hmm. Are disappeared. and fighting for the liberation. You see, what is even more worse is that these people, nobody's looking after them. These families, nobody's looking after them. They're on their own. Mm-hmm. And their only crime is that their parents or their family members have decided to fight for the freedom of this country.
These members that's currently in jail still, did they receive amnesty at the time of the TRC? No.
There are others who receive amnesty. And there are also statistics in terms of how many people were actually received the amnesty, how many did not receive amnesty. Mm-hmm. Now these people did not receive amnesty.
There's a number I see here, 40% of violations in the PAC camps, 40% were refused, 60% received. Armed robberies, 59 were granted amnesty, 41 not, and the list goes on and on.
Yeah.
But in your view, what should happen now, and do you think that there should be a second TRC?
Look, we've been campaigning now. Mm-hmm. We don't see, look, the first TRC in our own view, it does not, if the purpose was to tell the truth, it has not told the truth. It did not, particularly on major issues. We do not know. A lot of activities were actually of the, those activities that took place here, around late 80s. Mm-hmm. But to PAC, I think there's not been truth and there's not been justice. Mm-hmm. Maybe the second TRC, if any, with more broad terms of reference, which is seeking to go deep and reveal to the public and to the people, to this nation, as to what went wrong.
The Free Upla Prisoners campaign that you're running, any successes thus far?
No, so far we have embarked on a campaign. We believe it has limited successes. Mm-hmm. Because a number of Upla members were then released on very stringent conditions, mm-hmm. With some tags of trackers, mm-hmm. and so on and so forth. So it's like they've been released from the bigger prisons to the house prisons. Mm-hmm. So it's basically like house arrest.
Yes.
Because they are not in a position where they can pursue their life, their career, mm-hmm. and begin to build their future. Mm-hmm. And integrate properly in society, because they have to report several times to police stations. They are restricted to associate, to go to certain areas. No, that is not really freedom.
Mm-hmm. Mr. Moloto, thank you so much for joining us here in studio.
Thank you.
That was Narius Moloto, the PAC Secretary General, joining us here in studio. We continue that discussion, asking you that question. Do you think there should be a second TRC? Let us know on the Facebook page, on the Twitter handle. That is the question. Here are some of your live tweets as we continue today. Remember that you can send them through to our Twitter handle, at SABC Newsroom. This one from Bilela Khilwa says, the TRC was nothing but a political program designed to criminalize the struggle against apartheid. This one from Senzile says, SABC Newsroom, SABC News Online, yes, there is. There are still scores other South Africans who did not know the truth and find closure, who do not know the truth and find closure, as you just heard also there from the Secretary General from the PAC telling us. Now, these are some of the comments. You can let us know during the course of the program on the Twitter handle as well as on the Facebook page. Let's now go to the Facebook page to find out what you have to say there. And today we see that the Gauteng Department of Education's online learner admission campaign will face its real test, as thousands of parents are expected to apply for spaces for their children for next year in school. Then South Africa's gold mining company Sibanye Gold says it is disappointed by the lack of consultation over a revised black empowerment charter that was published by the mining industry. And then finally, the Nelson Mandela Foundation says Winnie Madikizela Mandela is still recovering in a Johannesburg hospital after undergoing back surgery. Those are some of your stories on the Facebook page. For more, you can go to the Facebook page, just search for Newsroom. You'll find us there and you'll take a look at all the news. But right now, we'll take a short break and we'll be right back after that.
The deepening hunger crisis in Malawi is threatening the survival of children.
And also it is the life-threatening part of malnutrition.
Malawi is facing its worst food crisis in 9 years.
Mugabe is the world's oldest sitting head of state ahead of Queen Elizabeth of Britain.
The veteran leader seeks to temporarily forget his party's problems and instead focus on his legacy.
But he shows no sign of slowing down or stepping down from power after 36 years in office.
High-level government delegation led by President Jacob Zuma has arrived in Namibia for a round of talks relating to the Southern African Customs Union. The president held talks on the issue with Botswana President Ian Khama yesterday. The Customs Union is aimed at improving trade and investment among member states.
President Jacob Zuma making a stopover in Botswana en route to Namibia. He is on a whirlwind tour to all SACU member states. There is consensus that this 100-year-old body needs a review to ensure that it benefits its members, the region and the continent. The meetings seek cooperation within custom union members.
We now have an opportunity to review the SACU so that we have a SACU we want. The SACU we will that will work for us. So President Zuma is on a listening mission so that when we finally have a SACU summit, we would all have listened to all our leadership.
But there is concern over payments of value-added tax on both sides of the border. Businessman Mkulusi Enoch owns a company which specializes in building warehouses and porter structures. He sources all his goods from South Africa.
You will find that they charge me 14% from that side. For example, for a 1 million goods, which is more than 114,000, it's around 114,000. So it takes about 3 months to claim that, and it kills the cash flow.
But according to SACU agreements, double taxation is not allowed.
I think it's largely a question of getting that information out, particularly to smaller traders, because you shouldn't have to pay value-added tax twice. You pay it once, not in more than one country.
The presidency says the visit to member state Lesotho will be decided in due course, but the outcome of the interactions will be made available after the Swaziland visit. Tsholofelo Mathibedi, SABC News, Gaborone, Botswana.
The African National Congress in the Northwest has thrown its weight behind President Jacob Zuma. It says calls made by the opposition and certain individuals are part of a concerted effort to cause harm and pandemonium in the country. The Provincial Executive Committee convened a joint meeting in Mahikeng with the party leaders, or the party leagues rather, to reflect on the Constitutional Court ruling on Nkandla.
The ANC in the Northwest says forces are behind the calls for President Zuma to step down.
We say they are free to express their view. They are part of the society we live under. But this won't deviate us from following the communication protocol of the ANC as understood by the duly elected leadership of the ANC.
The PAC maintains that the president has humbled himself before the nation, and his apology must be accepted.
Where can we get such a humble leader who is a president who is not arrogant and who takes society into confidence and say, I accept that A is human, I made mistakes, and I'm taking into my confidence as a president of the republic.
The party says it is now going to concentrate its energies on the forthcoming local government elections. Selota Tai, SABC News, Mahikeng.
Finance Minister Pravin Gordhan says that efforts to market the South African economy are yielding positive results. The minister is in the United States to try to reassure rating agencies not to downgrade South Africa's credit status. Minister Gordhan says that international investors are buying South African bonds. That's a move which suggests that there's improved confidence in the local economy. Securities exchange figures show that foreign investors bought a net 30 billion rands worth of South African bonds in 2016, compared with 10 billion rand in the same period last year. Now, yeah, take a look at some of your comments. At least 413 people are now known to have died in the earthquake that struck Ecuador. The country's government says the 7.8 magnitude quake struck Ecuador's Pacific coast on Saturday, and the search for survivors continues. Let's now take a look at some of the comments, and there's some of the pictures coming through from Ecuador that you can see. There's some of the survivors of the quake. You can let me know what's on your mind on the Twitter handle at SABC Newsrooms. Let's see if there is some of the comments there. This one from Marlon Velaz says, prayers to the people of Ecuador. Ecuador earthquake hashtag there. Let's take a look as if there's another one coming up. Well, let's see if there is. This one, well, there was one, and unfortunately was struck by something. We'll take a quick look at your weather forecast with Philip Hawkins, which is standing by right now. Morning, Phil.
Yeah, thank you very much and a very good morning. Let's take a look at what's going on in terms of your weather for today. First of all, we're going to take a look at what's been going on in your cloud cover. Really, we've been seeing very dense clouds forming over the last 12 hours over the Central African Central Interior regions there. We're also seeing a very strong cloud cell, and that, of course, is the result of a tropical cyclone. You can see the rotation there just off Africa's eastern coastline. It is just in the northern parts of Madagascar. It is going to affect rainfall, definitely going to affect wind speeds. So you can expect a lot of that really to be concentrated over the northern parts of Madagascar. But it's also going to bring in rainfall to the closer areas along Africa's shoreline. That, of course, means that you can expect rainfall if you are along Mozambique's far northern coastlines or the coastlines just north of that. Now, South Africa expects isolated showers for the most part during today. But warm temperatures anyway, we'll get into those just a minute. But as you can see, just isolated showers over parts of South Africa, moving north towards Angola, seeing isolated showers as well. And of course, by tomorrow, we're going to see a lot of those showers concentrating over that eastern coastline as a result of that tropical cyclone. Now, taking a look in a little bit more detail at what's going on in your city today, Cape Town peaks at 25 degrees, PE 24, and temperatures rising nicely into the higher 20s and early 30s as we look towards the rest of South Africa. Most of South Africa expecting at least isolated showers for today. Now, Gaborone peaks at 30 degrees, not a high chance of showers or thunder showers in that area. Lilongwe peaks at 27 degrees, and it is going to be dry. Now, Dar es Salaam is peaking at 33, but it is expecting dense cloud cover and isolated showers for today. As we said, that's largely the result of low pressure systems coming in from the Indian Ocean, and that, of course, being the tropical cyclone there. Juba's at 36 degrees, temperatures ranging through the 20s and 30s as we look towards, from Juba all the way towards Sana'a. You can expect a lot of cloud cover in the region, isolated to scattered showers as well. And a little bit of rainfall also forecast over Tehran for today, 19 degree maximums there, and temperatures ranging through the later 20s and early 30s, as we said, through the northern parts there. Ariad, a 38 degree high with rainfall forecast as well. Now, rainfall only really forecast through Rabat as well as Marrakesh. That's an approaching low pressure system which is causing that rainfall. But we're also going to see warmer temperatures continuing in Tripoli and Benghazi. So good news for the area. Los Palmas, a 21 degree maximum under partly cloudy skies. A very, very pleasant, mild day there. Monrovia and Conakry expecting rainfall, but that really is it for the western parts of Africa. Not much rainfall other than that whatsoever. And you can expect that to continue towards Lagos, just partly cloudy skies there. It all changes, though, from Yaounde moving south. We're going to see quite a bit of rainfall all the way throughout these areas. Mostly only isolated showers, so light rainfall really forecast for the area. Nothing to worry about there. This is where you can contact us, email us, weather@sabc.co.za, or give us a call, 011-714-5077. That's where we leave your weather for now. Stay tuned.
They are basically arresting him, continue to arrest him on behalf of the apartheid government.
We are dealing with effects. We are not dealing with the causes. And for as long as you deal with effects, we are never going to solve this problem.
What do these people need in prison? Why are they there? The PAC, as Dr. Pegu is saying, has been seeking answers, and they're not coming.
What kind of answers are you getting?
I really think I've answered that question.
I think it's a difficult question. I don't have an answer for it. How was it possible that they could operate with such impunity?
The only thing you want is closure.
The only thing we want is closure.
And unfortunately, I don't really have sympathy for the idea that if you're too old, you shouldn't stand trial.
That's Rights and Recourse with Dumile Mateza every Sunday at 2 p.m. Central African Time, only on the SABC News Channel.
Thank you.
It's Tuesday, the 19th of April, 2016. This is Newsroom on SABC News, Channel 404. If you've just joined us, Jumbo Africa, and a very warm welcome as we broadcast live from Auckland Park Studios, Johannesburg, South Africa, to the rest of the African continent. I'm Elvis Preston. I'll be with you until 12 o'clock. As you know, we're also streaming live on YouTube, with the entire show available on our YouTube channel. Today, we focus on the Truth and Reconciliation Commission, which marks 20 years since the first public hearings of the TRC. And many believe that there are a lot of unanswered questions and a lot of work still needs to be done, as some of the atrocities committed during apartheid remain unresolved. So the question on your screen right now, we're asking you, is there a need for a second Truth and Reconciliation Commission? You can send us your comments on our Twitter handle at SABC Newsroom, as well as on our Facebook page. But first, let's take a look at your news headlines. President Jacob Zuma leads a high-level government delegation for rounds of talks relating to the Southern African Customs Union. Bodies of the victims of the weekend bus crash in which ANC volunteers were involved will be taken to the Germiston mortuary. And emergency rescue personnel in Ecuador rejoice after saving two survivors from rubble caused by a massive earthquake that left over 410 people dead. Now those are all your headlines, but before we get to the news, let's find out from Kendall Makamate what's happening on the sports front. A very good morning, Kendall.
Elvis, good morning. Quite a lot happening on the sports front, most of it in awards ceremonies, but I do get ahead of myself. Let me greet our viewers as well. Good morning to you. This is what we have in the sports today.
The Delorious World Sportsman of the Year is Novak Djokovic.
The world of tennis celebrated as Novak Djokovic and Serena Williams named the Sportsman and Sportswoman of the Year at the annual Glorious World Sports Awards.
And the Swiss stars got it. Boop wins it.
And South Africa's wheelchair marathon ace Ernst van Dijk beaten into second place by Swiss Marcel Hug for the second time in a row at the Boston Marathon. All this as former Pakistan captain Inzamam Ul Haq gets the nod to take over as his country's chief selector. That's what we've got for you in the sports in about 20 minutes or so. Back to Elvis for the news.
Thank you, Kendall. Let's now take a look at your top story. A high-level government delegation led by President Jacob Zuma has arrived in Namibia for a round of talks relating to the Southern African Customs Union. The president held talks on the issue with Botswana's president, Ian Khama, yesterday. The customs union is aimed at improving trade and investment among member states.
President Jacob Zuma making a stop over in Botswana en route to Namibia. He is on a whirlwind tour to all SACU member states. There is consensus that this 100-year-old body needs a review to ensure that it benefits its members, the region and the continent. The meetings seek cooperation within custom union members.
We now have an opportunity to review the SACU so that we have a SACU we want. The SACU we will that will work for us. President Zuma is on a listening mission so that when we finally have a SACU summit, we would all have listened to all our leadership.
But there is concern over payments of value-added tax on both sides of the border. Businessman Mkulusi Enoch owns a company which specializes in building warehouses and porter structures. He sources all his goods from South Africa.
You will find that they charge me 14% from that side. For example, for a 1 million goods, which is more than 114,000, it's around 114,000. So it takes about 3 months to claim that, and it kills the cash flow.
But according to SACU agreements, double taxation is not allowed.
I think it's largely a question of getting that information out, particularly to smaller traders, because you shouldn't have to pay value-added tax twice. You pay it once, not in more than one country.
The presidency says the visit to member state Lesotho will be decided in due course, but the outcome of the interactions will be made available after the Swaziland visit. Tsholofelo Mathibedi, SABC News, Gaborone, Botswana.
The African National Congress in the Northwest has thrown its weight behind President Jacob Zuma. It says calls made by the opposition and certain individuals are part of a concerted effort to cause harm and pandemonium in the country. The Provincial Executive Committee convened a joint meeting in Mai Kang with the party leagues to reflect on the Constitutional Court ruling on Kandla.
The ANC in the Northwest says the forces are behind the calls for President Zuma to step down.
We say they are free to express their view. They are part of the society we live under. But this won't deviate us from following the communication protocol of the ANC as understood by the duly elected leadership of the ANC.
The PAC maintains that the president has humbled himself before the nation, and his apology must be accepted.
Where can we get such a humble leader who is a president who is not arrogant and who takes society into confidence and say, I accept that A is human, I made mistakes, and I'm taking into my confidence as a president of the republic.
The party says it is now going to concentrate its energies on the forthcoming local government elections. Selota Tai, SABC News, Mahikeng.
United Nations Secretary General Ban Ki-moon has proposed sending up to 3,000 police officers to Burundi, where political violence has been simmering for a year. However, he's warned the Security Council that Burundi's government has indicated that it will only accept 20 unarmed policing experts.
The report seen by SABC News says the deployment of the police officers would enhance the UN's capacity to maintain situational awareness, to deepen analysis of the security situation and promote respect for human rights. The contingents could also report potential risks to the Security Council in a timely manner. Option one envisages the deployment of 3,000 police personnel and is the only option, according to the report, that would provide some degree of physical protection to the population against increased threats. The second option involves the deployment of some 228 police officers working together with human rights monitors that would provide situational awareness and early warning capacities if things were to spiral out of control. But this is important, it would not provide any physical protection to the population. The final option is focused on the strategic engagement with and the assessment of the National Police of Burundi. It would have a light footprint of between 20 and 50 troops and would largely be confined to the capital, Bujumbura. Communication, though, from the government of Burundi has already indicated it would not be in any agreement with any large-scale UN police presence, but was ready to receive some 20 unarmed police experts to provide support. Of course, all these are mere recommendations for now and will have to be vetted by the Security Council that will take a decision on which option to implement through a new resolution. It remains unclear for now how soon before the Council will reconvene on this matter and how the government's opposition to any major deployment might affect any future decision.
Brazil's president Dilma Rousseff vows to fight to the bitter end against efforts to impeach her. On Sunday, the lower house of Congress approved impeachment proceedings against President Rousseff, who was accused of illegally manipulating budget figures. In her first reaction to the vote, she says her conscience is clear and that she has committed or that she has committed no illegal act. President Rousseff's opponents reached the 342 vote mark needed to send her impeachment to the Senate for trial. The impeachment vote has split the coalition alliances in Brazil after the president accused her vice president, Michel Temer, of plotting against her. Now, if Rousseff is unseated, Temer will take over. On to New York now. New Yorkers find themselves in the midst of the presidential primary storm today as the state becomes the latest to weigh in on who will become the nominees for the Democratic and Republican parties. All polling data shows comfortable leads for both Hillary Clinton, who is the former senator for New York, and local businessman Donald Trump. Democratic challenger Bernie Sanders continues to draw huge crowds to campaign events, while Trump's main challenger believes that he can prevent the tycoon from clinching enough delegates to secure the nomination before the Republican Party's convention in July.
It's a fight to the finish, and delegate-rich New York State has become crucial to anyone's math.
There are a lot of differences between me and my opponents, both in the Democratic primary and in the Republican primary. And I can tell you this, I will not let someone like Donald Trump or Ted Cruz say what he is saying about the people, the hardworking people, including immigrants, but everyone who works hard in New York.
She leads Bernie Sanders in the delegate count by over 200 delegates, while New York offers an additional 247 delegates on a proportional basis. And while his path to the nomination is narrowing, Bernie Sanders' message of income inequality continues to resonate with millions across this country. Almost 30,000 came to see him in Brooklyn this weekend.
I believe when you have a handful of financial institutions in which the top six have assets equivalent to 58% of the GDP of this country, when they issue two-thirds of the credit cards and one-third of the mortgages, the time is now to break them up.
Overall, Donald Trump holds an almost 200-delegate lead and a 30-point polling cushion over his nearest rival in the state, but has bemoaned complex party rules that have allowed his closest rival, Ted Cruz, a sniff at the nomination.
The system is a bad, bad system, and they got to do something about it. The Republican National Committee, they better get going, because I'll tell you what, you're going to have a rough July at that convention. You better get going, and you better straighten out the system, because the people want their vote. The people want to vote, and they want to be represented properly.
Both frontrunners hoping their home state will offer no surprises in their quest for the nomination. Shervin Brysby's SABC News, New York.
Now let's get back to the question that we posed to you, and of course we want to engage you on that on that question on the Facebook page as well as on the Twitter handle at SABC Newsroom. We're asking you the question, is there a need for a second Truth and Reconciliation Commission this morning? Let us know what's on your mind. Now this year marked 20 years, the anniversary since the start of the TRC, or the Truth and Reconciliation Commission. The commission formed an integral part of South Africa's post-democratic development. The TRC proposed that truth would open the way to reconciliation. Kulamani and member organizations of the South African Coalition on Transitional Justice are working on submissions to the Department of Justice to assist in their adoption after so many years of the comprehensive program of reparations to redress the damage suffered by the victims in their contribution to the liberation struggle in South Africa. Now, to talk to us about this, we are joined in studio by Dr. Marjorie Jacobson, the National Director of the Kulamani Support Group. Doctor, very good morning to you and welcome.
Thank you very much, Elvis.
Now, 20 years since the Truth and Reconciliation Commission, are you hopeful that 2016 might be the year where government take this recommendations by the TRC and adopt them?
Elvis, what we know from the track record of these transitional processes around the world is that it generally takes 20 to 30 years to resolve the issues. So processes are initiated, and unfortunately our process was incredibly short for the agenda of 34 years of atrocities it had to address. But usually processes continue for 6 to 10 years at least. Mm-hmm. That is international practice, and we are in a process of dialogue with the minister who believes that a lot of focus has been put on perpetrators and amnesty hearings and special pardons and now paroles for people, mm-hmm. and that he needs to bring back into focus that there has not been adequate attention mm-hmm. to victims and their rehabilitation.
Mm-hmm. Now, earlier we heard that, perhaps the TRC has done its work. That's what they say. But do you believe that that was really done, or are we perhaps failing the TRC in terms of the recommendations that's on the table?
Right, well, the recommendations of the TRC that were published in 1998 are exceptional. They're used as a benchmark all over the world. Mm. But following that publication, the recommendations were not wholeheartedly implemented. Mm. They reached only just over 17,000 people. And so there's a huge body of people who were excluded on what the minister agrees are bureaucratic administrative failures. Mm. And so we are looking at how we can address that, mm-hmm. How much money remains in the President's Fund, which is a key thing, mm-hmm. Whether we can actually get back to having companies make a significant contribution, because they don't understand the level of disrepair that continues mm-hmm. to exist in the country.
Only 17,000 people reached thus far. How many has not been reached?
That's about 10% of the people who should have been reached. I mean, we mm-hmm. have records of just over 100,000 people who suffered gross human rights violations. We mm-hmm. had to be very restrictive in terms of what the TRC was mandated to deal with. Mm-hmm. And for those people, we've worked for many, many years on programs to facilitate their healing, their empowerment to be able to begin economic activities. Mm-hmm. We now being approached by the Department of Higher Education to train graduates in those programs, because our universities have not developed training for social workers and other people in mm-hmm. these kinds of programs mm-hmm. that we discover need to be community-based and group-based, because very few people have access to a few centers in the middle of cities.
Over 100,000 people. Are we talking about individuals, families, or are we talking about communities here?
Mostly individuals who were in communities that were particularly targeted. Mm-hmm. So this is a real area of quite deep discussion with the minister, mm-hmm. because it means designing collective remedies for people. Mm-hmm. And, for instance, where they had all their livestock stolen and all their homes burned down, there are ways that you can redress that. Mm-hmm. And so the minister and his new sort of incumbents in senior management in justice, I think, are very, very serious about mm-hmm. trying to do justice for victims now.
Mm-hmm. Eskulamani, do you have a comprehensive program, really, to take forward the reparations for all South Africans, Doctor?
Well, for all South Africans, mm-hmm. it includes things like the problems with land restitution, mm-hmm. which is continuing with the claims being reopened till June 2019. Yes. But we believe the programs that we've had to develop are worth supporting. Mm-hmm. We now sit with government on the National Victim Empowerment Management Committee, mm-hmm. so we see much more collaboration with government in terms of getting the kind of programs down to people where they are organized. Mm-hmm. Our structures are organized around 10 coordinating points in every province, mm-hmm. so we have quite an extensive network of people, and we're moving more into training the next generation in skills like setting up community knowledge centers with access to IT training, so mm-hmm. young people don't have to flee to the cities to get access to these kinds of trainings. Mm-hmm.
And how is that going in terms of empowering the communities and getting access to it?
Well, we've had, I think, quite a lot of success. Mm. We've trained people in how to look after water resources, mm. monitor the health of rivers, teach young people to start water for dignity, mm-hmm. sanitation programs. So, I mean, all those social and economic rights that are provided for in the Constitution, mm-hmm. but which you cannot just sit around and wait for them to be delivered, because mm-hmm. citizens can facilitate that mm-hmm. they become a reality.
From the Kulamani Support Group's perspective, do you think there was some shortcomings from the TRC?
There were a lot of shortcomings mm-hmm. And a lot of very serious gaps, mm-hmm. And we're still dealing with that, and I'm very grateful that, I mean, Archbishop Tutu himself always said, don't see this as an end, don't close the book, It has to be a journey, and we're very aware of that journey. We're very grateful that the National Prosecuting Authority is now beginning to criminally prosecute people who were denied amnesty. Mm-hmm. So that's a really important agenda, because amnesty hearings did not cross-examine people who applied and did not cross-involve witnesses in their hearings. Mm-hmm. So the sense of Kulumani members who attended those hearings was that this wasn't the truth, the full truth. It was a constructed narrative that might help these offenders to get amnesty. Mm-hmm. So a lot of that truth-telling ongoing process still has to happen. And we find that people are willing to come forward now because their jobs are no longer threatened. Mm-hmm. People who used to work in the police and the security branch, they are really willing to come forward and speak about what mm-hmm. they were witness to, largely.
How do we change that narrative in order to bring reparation to the rest of the South Africans that haven't felt reparation, that they had reparation during the process?
What government argues is in terms of how many people now have access to piped water, which is a part of 83% of the population, how many houses have been built. For us, those are very important measures and achievements, mm-hmm. but we are very sad that it hasn't been done with citizen participation. Mm-hmm. All of those services can be done with empowering local people to learn the skills, not just in a sort of road cleaning, clearing alien vegetation, but in development of real skills, and that's what we've been trying to pioneer, mm-hmm. because there's enough work for everybody.
Yes. Doctor, just lastly, now we do agree, or even some of the previous speakers, that the recommendations of the TRC was adequate, but do you think that we do need a second TRC?
We think that we need a reopening of certain processes. Mm-hmm. That has been normal practice after truth commissions all mm-hmm. over the world. Certainly processes where government can validate all the statements we've mm-hmm. taken and then include those people in access to applying for education assistance and health and housing and some financial assistance. Mm-hmm. Because that's been what has prevented people from making progress in their lives. So mm-hmm. I think it's perfectly possible. Mm-hmm. And I believe the minister supports us in that view.
Dr. Jacobson, thank you so much for joining us here in studio.
Thank you.
That was Dr. Marjorie Jacobson. She's the National Director of the Kulumani Support Group. We're asking you the very same question on the Twitter handle as well as on the Facebook page. This is our theme for today. We're looking at 20 years of the TRC, and we're asking you, is there perhaps time or a need for a second Truth and Reconciliation Commission? Let me know what's on your mind on the Facebook page and on the Twitter handle. Now, let's move on. 1 in 5 children in Myanmar aged 10 to 17 go to work instead of school. Now, this according to figures from a census report on employment published last month. Myanmar, the law there, bars children under 13 from working in shops or factories and says that teenagers aged 13 to 15 should not work more than 4 hours a day or at night.
Tun Min slides his boots on every morning and heads to work in the outskirts of Yangon. The 16-year-old Burmese teen is the sole breadwinner for his family and earns about $8 a day delivering fish to the market. He's been doing this since he was 12, when he had to drop out of school because his mother became ill. I want to become a trader in the fish market, he says. I need money to start my business. Then I can earn even more money. The demand for labor has risen drastically since the Myanmar economy opened up 5 years ago. Here, about 1 in 5 children aged 10 to 17 go to work instead of school, despite laws that curb child labor. Michael Slingsby from the United Nations Development Program said there's a fine line between protecting children and the demand for economic development.
I think it should be a priority area, but needs to be combined with positive policies. If you try to ban child labor, there's a danger that you drive it underground, and people still continue to work very young, but do it in a less open way.
Aung San Suu Kyi's National League for Democracy Party, which took power this month, said tackling child labor was one of the party's goals.
Syrian peace talks came close to collapse with the mainstream opposition announcing a pause in talks at the United Nations headquarters in Geneva although it agreed to keep its negotiating team in the city. The Western Back Opposition High Negotiations Committee, or the HNC, said in a letter to rebel fighters that government military advances meant a ceasefire was effectively over, and it was calling a postponement in the talks.
Scenes from the front lines in Syria. Amateur video, which cannot be independently verified, shows an ambulance rushing through the streets and homes. A familiar sight in an ongoing war that has already claimed the lives of some 250,000 people. This is the backdrop for talks in Geneva aimed at ending the war. Opposition leaders from the HNC, or High Negotiations Committee, agreed to come to the table, but less than a handful showed up for talks. And now the UN mediator, Stephane de Mistura, announces the opposition is stepping back.
I heard today, by meeting the delegation of the HNC, their intention to postpone their formal participation in the Palais to the negotiations in order to express their own displeasure and concern on the humanitarian situation degradation and on the problems related to the cessation of hostilities.
They will remain in Geneva until the end of the week for informal discussions. But with violence escalating again on the ground, peace looks elusive. As de Mistura warned that the gap between the opposition and the government remains, quote, wide.
Along we celebrate those who take strides doing good and changing the world.
I really, really think that education has to be revisited, and it's an integral part of teaching young people skills of the future.
There's always light at the end of the tunnel.
I think that the treatment should be made available, actually, because it's costly. Growth hormones are very, very costly.
Where there's a challenge, we bring hope.
I'm alive. And the punch tumor is gone.
Join your host, Buleng Malabati, every Friday at 17:30 for more uplifting stories.
We're heading to a future of cars that will drive themselves, and a place where robots will be doing some of our chores. But the challenge in Africa is to make sure that everyone is part of this new world.
To be behind with technology, it is a challenge for us as offenders.
There are many initiatives to ensure that Africans are truly connected.
We're now giving more access and internet to now the end users.
On Network, we have information on Africa's technology landscape, possibilities for the future, and some great African innovations. That's Network with Ms. Pumelele Zondi, every Sunday at 7:30 p.m. Central African Time.
Good morning, welcome back. My name is Kendall Makhamat, and I've got your sports on Newsroom. Now, our top story is about the Laureus Sports Awards, where top tennis players Novak Djokovic and Serena Williams were named the Sportsman and Sportswoman of the Year at the annual Laureus World Sports Awards in Berlin, Germany. The awards honor the greatest sporting achievements by individuals and teams throughout the year.
The who's who of the sporting world gathered in Berlin to celebrate those who achieved excellence in their game in 2015. Djokovic and Williams were the cream of the crop.
The Laureus World Sportsman of the Year is Novak Djokovic.
The Serbian world number one reached all four Grand Slam singles finals last year. He won three. his only loss coming at the French Open to Stanislas Wawrinka.
I dedicate this award to two people that have inspired me not only tonight but throughout their lives and careers in so many different ways, and I want to thank them for the legacy. I want to thank them for their wisdom and for blessing us with wonderful words that we are all going to follow, at least I will, Mr. Niki Lauda and Mr. Jochen Cruyff.
So Serena Williams. In a remarkable year, Serena won the Australian, French and Wimbledon titles, giving her all four Grand Slam titles at the same time.
Williams, who did not attend the event, also won three of the four Grand Slam women's singles titles last year and was named the WTA's Player of the Year for the seventh time. Brazil's Paralympic swimmer Daniel Dias was named Sportsperson of the Year with a Disability. This after he bagged seven gold medals at last year's IPC Swimming World Championships in Glasgow, Scotland. Rugby World Cup winning New Zealand took the Team of the Year accolade. The All Blacks became the first team ever to win back-to-back World Cups when they beat Australia in the final at Twickenham.
It was a heap of hard work, and you know, not just from players but from management that set out to get on that path, and to achieve it in October last year was pretty special.
All Black fly half Dan Carter won the Comeback of the Year award. Carter was named Man of the Match in the final in England after missing the 2011 edition due to injury. After victory at both the Masters and US Open last year, US golfer Jordan Spieth was rewarded with the Breakthrough of the Year award. And three-time Formula One world champion Niki Lauda received a Lifetime Achievement Award at the ceremony, while a special Spirit of Sport Award was given posthumously to Dutch soccer legend Johan Cruyff, who passed away 3 weeks ago. His son Jordi received the award on his behalf. Liesel Zankel, SABC News.
Looks like it was a wonderful ceremony. Now moving on to other sporting news, Switzerland's Marcel Hug denied South African Ernst van Dijk a record 11th title when he beat van Dijk by 1 second to win the 2016 Boston Marathon. This was Hug's second consecutive men's wheelchair title in Boston after edging van Dijk last year as well. Hug crossed the finish line in a time of 1 hour, 24 minutes and 1 second.
Race course, Al. Having surrendered his title to Marcelo Hug of Switzerland last year, Ernst van Dijk went into this year's Boston Marathon looking to cement his legacy in the event. 2 years ago, van Dijk made wheelchair racing history when he became the first athlete to win 10 Boston Marathon titles. It was always going to be a big ask for van Dijk, with the 6 former winners taking part in this year's race. The South African, however, took the early lead with the chasing pack hot on his heels. It was not long, though, before Hug overtook the 2012 London Olympic silver medalist. In the end, the Swiss outsprinted both van Dijk and Australian Kite Finley to claim his second consecutive Boston crown, while the South African edged Finley by inches to finish second.
Ernst, how did it go for you? That was just a thrilling finish. Three men abreast going down Boylston.
Yeah, you know, there was so much happening in the race. Like, in the beginning, I had a bit of a gap, and then another guy pulled about 20 guys back to me, and then Marcel made a big jump and Kurt went with him. It dropped me every time we hit a hill and every time I had to fight back. So to come up second, this is the start of the wheelchair majors, and this is the way to start.
Well, we've got one winner today, but three great champions coming across the line.
Meanwhile, in the women and men's able-bodied athletes, Ethiopian Atsedi Beisa and Lemi Hali were both crowned 2016 Boston Marathon champions. Joseph Mohali, SABC News.
Now, Ethiopian runners Lemi Beranu Haile and Atsedi Beisa won their respective able-bodied races to make it a 1-2 for their nation. Haile won the men's race in 2 hours, 12 minutes and 45 seconds. And the first woman to cross the line was compatriot Atsedi Beisa, who won in 2 hours, 29 and 19 seconds. Now, boxing fans are in for a treat later this month when four world title fights will be held at one tournament. The showcase takes place in Polokwane on the 29th of April.
Tonight it was announced that IBO welterweight champion Tsika Molebetsi will defend his title against Mexican Jesus Jorello on a night which will see four world title fights in Polokwane on the 29th of April. In another fight, Gideon Buthelezi will defend his IBO junior bantamweight title against Namibia's Diego Potato. Malcolm Clarkson and Mexican Leonelo Miranda will battle it out for the vacant WBA junior lightweight title. And lastly, the last world title fight on the night will see Bongani Silila take on Namibia's Jafet Utoni for the vacant WBO Junior Flyweight title.
It has never happened in the history of boxing in South Africa where four prominent titles were put at stake in one night. This is what is needed in the country so that we can say boxing is back. This is what motivates other people to join the forces in the sports of boxing.
The two defending world champions are confident of retaining their titles.
I'm very ready. I've been training ever since from my last fight in December. So, but then only last 2 months back I started camping.
Well, the Mexicans, they're too strong and they're coming forward. Yeah. Anything can happen, but I know one thing, I'm going to defend my title by knockout. I don't know where I'm going.
This boxing extravaganza will be brought to you by SABC Sport.
Our involvement as the SABC really is to bring the sport to the people. We want to revive the sporting code, boxing sporting code. So we're going to be broadcasting these fights on all our radio stations and our TV platforms.
On the undercard, there will also be a provincial junior welterweight, junior featherweight, and a bantamweight clash.
29th of April, mark that date, something to look out for. Now, South Africa finished fourth overall at this year's opening World Cup rowing event in Varese, Italy. It was the first proper warm-up event for the Olympic Games in Rio. They beat countries such as the USA and Great Britain, as they collected 2 gold and 2 bronze medals.
I think it's always good to come out on top. Not all the big guys are here this weekend necessarily, but we've had a lot of time to sort of first race back in the double for the last season and really got to work on some good stuff, the stuff we've been doing in the training to see how it comes into the racing. So really good for us. Happy with how we started.
We still have internal selection, so even though we've qualified the boat, the athletes as us still has to qualify within our country selection. So we still have a lot to do to make sure that we're in the boat. But as Chris said, this is a good first step.
Amongst us, we have an attitude of excellence and going for gold. So we're driving each other. I mean, not only is it Ursula and I and the other lightweights back home, but I mean the heavyweight women, the lightweight men, heavyweight men, we're all racing against each other every single day during the week. So we have this, we want to be the best in the squad. And I think it's obviously you can see at this World Cup with so many of our boats excelling.
Now for a little bit of British football, with Tottenham Hotspur's Harry Kane and Dele Alli scored a brace each to earn the team a 4-0 victory at Stoke City. The visitors took full advantage of log leaders Leicester City's 2-2 home draw with West Ham United and closed the gap to 5 points with 4 matches remaining.
Dembele. Back for Kane. Loves to shoot from this sort of area and shoot like that. It's another masterpiece from Harry Kane. Better of him. Well, that's the best we've seen from Stoke so far. Christian Eriksen, it's opened up for him. Oh, he's rattled the bar, and he really should have scored. It's a wonderful ball from Christian Eriksen, and Ali makes no mistake. And Spurs have the second goal that they were craving. Pochettino was craving. Is Pat Lamela's offside, is he? But the flag has stayed down, and he gives the goal for Kane, and it is 3-0. Eriksen, don't rule out a fourth for Tottenham. Oh, there you are, right on cue. 2 for Dele Alli now. It's a super.
Now that was a mauling if there ever was one. Now history will be made tonight with the first CAF Champions League midweek fixtures scheduled across the continent. Games are also scheduled for Wednesday as the African football body reacts to pressure from some national associations wanting more weekends reserved for domestic fare. The aggregate winner in this round of fixtures will proceed to the group stages of the Champions League, while the loser will be relegated to the Confederation Cup. We will be bringing you a full list of fixtures in the next bulletin. In the meantime, we'll take a short break and know that Elvis Presley is standing by with more news and analysis. You're watching Newsroom.
Good afternoon, you're watching the Midday Report.
Lunchtime news amplified.
But for now,
This is what they call home. Their hope to shift to higher ground seems to be against the tide.
Midday Report provides you with more than just news stories.
I just want Port Elizabeth to know that they own a world-class theatre.
Good afternoon, you're with the news at 1 in the headlines.
Very good afternoon to you. This is News Live. I'm Natasha Thorpe. Let's take a quick look at what's coming up in your headlines.
Good afternoon and welcome to A View from the House.
For all things news, tune in to Midday Report weekdays at 12 noon only on the SABC News Channel. News Today takes an in-depth look on news locally, continentally, and globally. We bring the world to your home. We cover all economy news extensively to keep you informed. We are live to break news as and when they happen across the world. We analyze news using experts in all aspects. Make a date with News Today every Monday to Friday from 3 to 5:30 p.m.
Welcome back. You're watching Newsroom. Now, world cities are increasingly relying on technology to improve the lives of its citizens. Now, this could be from a cashless public transport system, internet access that's available in public spaces, and digitizing government services so that you, the residents of different cities, you don't have to stand in long queues like we always do. Joining us now in studio to talk about the creation of smart cities here on in South Africa is the Deputy Minister of Telecommunications and Postal Services, Professor Shlengiwe Mkhize. Professor, very good morning to you and welcome.
Good morning. Thank you for having me.
First and foremostly, tell us, what is a smart city, or was that adequately enough as I described it?
I think it's adequate for the purpose. Mm-hmm. Maybe I can just elaborate to say, as the department, we have a responsibility to roll out the ICT infrastructure, from broadband, Wi-Fi, fiber, satellites, you name it.
Yes.
So our metros in particular, I mean, I know at face value, everybody's thinking about Tshwane.
Yes.
In just last week, we were at Ekurhuleni, the same thing there. They've got Wi-Fi hotspots. You can connect from the school to the library to the health clinic. But also, these smart cities are critical for things like utilities to be able to constantly monitor what is going on grid and alert the consumers. It becomes important also to look at water services, transport and logistics.
Yes.
As owners of these transport buses, sometimes you could monitor and say, now they are here. The sheep, you need to monitor. Now they are here. They have to rest for an hour or two. They have to kick off of this time. It has got security elements, but also strong elements of efficiency.
Why is it important for this creation of smart cities in South Africa?
You know, we are creating an information society. For instance, if kids have to register, as you can see now in Gauteng, with the abundance of technologies, the MEC have said, let's do it online on time. So he's improving service to the people, but also making life easy so that the experience of government service has an element of pleasure, not a pain of moving from one office to another. And of course, the real challenges of networks, not, you know, technology sometimes being overloaded and so on, which is is really a positive stress. Once they're up and running, it's going to make life so easy for parents to get the student number, get information on books, on uniforms, so that on that day they are ready to sit down and get on with their work.
Now, it is a step in the right direction, but of course that very same system that we're talking about, it crashed last week. What are you going to do to make sure that this does not happen and some of the challenges that they experience currently does not happen with the creation of a smart city?
You know, what's important to say is that government is working in a highly coordinated fashion. Mm-hmm. For instance, the State Information Technology Agency, CETA, which is our own agency, oversees the networks of all government departments. Mm-hmm. We're doing that so that we don't have a situation whereby each department procures its own technology, then it's fragmented, it's costly, and it's up to the CETA agency now, then the network technicians, mm-hmm. to look at what is going wrong and to step in and improve that immediately. You saw recently with the e-channel of Home Affairs.
Yes, yes.
It has taken us too long. Mm-hmm. The minister was talking about millions of smart cards that are not collected, mm-hmm. but now they've partnered with the banks, and still CETA is at the center, mm-hmm. and to make sure that you can go to a bank and access your smart card much quicker in a more efficient ways. Mm-hmm.
Now, those are some of the very positive stories, because people don't have to stand in queues, long queues, and wait for these things anymore. But are there critical areas, Deputy Minister, that you'll be concentrating on during the course of building up to the smart city?
You know, these Wi-Fi hotspots, they bring also another element of illiteracy. We now need to step up our efforts so that if people, for instance, they have got access to end-user gadgets, mm-hmm. as we have been doing at schools. Yes. It shouldn't be a source of frustration for teachers. It shouldn't be a source of frustration for health workers, mm-hmm. not knowing how to ensure that they accurately load data, information. Because if we don't promote the use this, the ICT laboratories, mm-hmm. to equip the first line service providers with know-how, how to use them efficiently. And people must stop thinking, oh, I was born before technology. They must just be comfortable.
Yeah, they call you like, BC that
yes,
time, hey?
Yeah, they must just be confident and ensure that they use them. Mm-hmm. It's all about making government services much more efficient.
Because that was going to be my next question. Although we have the tools now that citizens can access, but do they have the skills to do that? And will there be somebody that will train them or assist them to do this, to access these systems?
You know, we have a regulator which oversees the performance of those who are licensed, the mobile operators. And one of the things, the conditions we are saying to them, make sure that capacity building becomes part of the package. Last week we were in the Eastern Cape. We saw people now, they've got district offices where teachers are trained. Mm. So we hope the Minister of Basic Education will make it compulsory and actually give them points for attending, going through those lessons. Mm. And our companies were saying to them, it's not about installing the infrastructure and walking away. Yes. That will be ticking a box. Mm-hmm. Your technicians, the local service providers, mm-hmm. should make regular checkups to see that technology is efficient, is working well, there are no ons and offs, because that again will take mm-hmm. away the good experience yes. of technology.
Now, just briefly, Deputy Minister, because we run out of time, data is very expensive, and of course we have the rural areas. Will they be capacitated as well?
Well, broadband rollout really mm-hmm. mandates us to start in the most remote rural areas. Mm. We're in discussion with Telkom, because they have the largest footprint of fiber. They've done it during 2010 to assist us to make sure that we use the post office, we digitize it, so that the rural people are also part of South Africa Connect, mm-hmm. which is really the vision for the future of an equitable society.
Deputy Minister, thank you so much for your time and joining us here in studio.
Thank you.
Now, that was the Deputy Minister of Telecommunications and Postal Services, Professor Shlengiwe Mkhize, joining us in studio. Now, staying with all things high-tech tools, the Department of Home Affairs recently launched the eHome Affairs portal, and it encouraged South Africans to apply for IDs using their online applications and avoid the queues. We just talked about that. Now, while the department encourages the use of their online application, there are risks attached to any online applications. Recently, we were joined in studio by Jackie Fick, the head of forensic services at Cell C, and I began by asking her, why is it important for one to remain safe while you're applying online? And here is what she had to say.
This is why it's very important to keep safe when you are on cyber, in the cyber world. I always say that using cyber technology is like a young democracy. We have learned the convenience and all the rights that we have online, but we must be very careful to also know that there is responsibilities when transacting online.
Now, phones are always open to cybercrime as well. How should one secure their phone and avoid cyber hacking?
Firstly, I think if you deal with a phone these days, forget it's a phone. We don't just use it anymore just to make a call. A phone is a computer. So everything that you used to do on a computer, you now do on your phone. Securing your phone, you apply the same measures as you would. Passwords, fingerprint identification, lock screen patterns that you can use to secure your phone.
So there's measures that you can use and implement on your phone to make sure that you're not a victim.
Exactly. Firstly, make the device safe. Antivirus software. Be very careful where you connect. I'm just looking at your introduction now on Home Affairs, and the first thing that comes to mind is, will that application be available on a mobile platform so that you can also apply on a mobile phone? Or do people know how dangerous it is, for example, to apply when using an open Wi-Fi network where anybody can listen into your conversations or into the transactions that you do online?
Now, to protect yourself, you mentioned antivirus software, but these can be imitated, and it could be software that you download, which is not the correct one.
That is indeed so, Alice, and that is why it's very important when you download software that you download it from a trusted source. Like, for example, the App Store, Google Play, and not to go and click on these advertisements that keep on popping up on your phone saying, your phone is at risk, you've got 770 viruses, click here to get rid of all your problems. Rather go to the approved store so that you know that what you're downloading is indeed true and correct.
Now, email hacking is so common, but people still fail to adhere to the warnings. How do you deal with that as a precaution when you use email as well?
Email hacking, are you referring to 419 scams?
Yes.
The ones where you've won the lottery,
yes.
Preferably the OMO or the RICA lottery, but I need to inform you I've already won those ones. The first rule is, if it is sounds too good to be true, it probably is.
Yes.
Don't respond to it, because the whole purpose of that email is to get you to respond and to depart with your good personal information.
Final advice, Jackie, to anyone out there listening to us today.
My advice is, don't make the cyber world complicated. It is complicated enough. When you think about transacting online, think if you would have done that transaction in the real world as a start.
Wonderful. Jackie, thank you so much for joining us.
Thank you, Albert.
Now, that was Jackie Fick, the head of forensic services. Some good advice for you working on your phone and perhaps on your PC or your iPad and all these other things that you utilize. Think twice. Think twice indeed. Now, let's take a look at some of the front pages of the newspapers around the African continent. And we're starting off in Zimbabwe, where the Herald reports that the government is committed to improving the welfare of civil servants by matching their salaries to the poverty datum line. Government pledge better pay, it says also there. Moving to Angola. The Jornal de Angola says that the net international reserves of Angola are estimated at $24 billion, accounting for 8 months of imports of goods and equipment necessary for the market. The governor of the National Bank of Angola announced yesterday at a meeting of consultation to entrepreneurs promoted by the Ministry of Economy.
And then finally in Nigeria, the Daily Trust reports that the Economic and Financial Crimes Commission yesterday took into custody the former senior special assistant to ex-president Goodluck Jonathan, Owarimafowe Adudafa, over allegations of financial crimes to the tune of 10 billion naira. It says they're reps to buy 3.6 billion cars. Yeah, there you have it. 3.6 billion naira being used there to buy cars. Now, that's all the newspapers we have for you here on Newsroom. Up next is your short weather forecast looking at the continent.
News Today keeps you informed with news locally and around the world.
When Judge John Thorpe challenged the Supreme Court of Appeal when it sent the matter back and said that there must be an inquiry set up.
We unpack business news.
There's an increase in general inflation in the country.
We give you up-to-date news of the day.
The drugs were seized at several locations in Sydney, including a shipping container sent from Hong Kong. Police say it's the largest haul of illicit drugs in 2 years.
We round up sports news.
Kotatsu, tell me about the legacy that you would like to build and be remembered for.
Trying to get my foundation running, which is going to focus on, you know, all the sport, doesn't matter disability or able body. So, I mean, I'm passionate about sports.
Stay informed every Monday to Friday from 3 to 5:30 p.m. CAT. SABC News.
They are basically arresting him, continue to arrest him on behalf of the apartheid government.
We are dealing with effects. We are not dealing with the causes. And for as long as we deal with effects, we are never going to solve this problem.
What do these people need in prison? Why are they there? The PAC, as Dr. Pegu is saying, has been seeking answers, and they're not coming.
What kind of answers are you getting?
I really think I've answered that question.
I think it's a difficult question. I don't have an answer for it. How was it possible that they could operate with such impunity?
The only thing you want is closure.
The only thing we want is closure. And unfortunately, I don't really have sympathy for the idea that if you're too old, you shouldn't stand trial.
That's Rights and Recourse with Dumile Mateza every Sunday at 2 p.m. Central African Time, only on the SABC News Channel.
Tonight in an SABC exclusive news expose, we show you how firearm proficiency certificates are fraudulently sold for a few thousand rand.
What you did was illegal. Do you at least acknowledge that? What you did is illegal.
I say it could be probably illegal.
Nigeria is Africa's second largest tomato producer.
The chief executive of Enrisco says he started the company with a capital of $75 million.
The problem now is that the market has been created in China.
He says that doing business in the country is becoming more difficult every day.
It's Tuesday, the 19th of April, 2016. This is Newsroom on SABC News, Channel 404, Jumbo Africa. And a very warm welcome to the final hour as we broadcast live from our Auckland Park studios in Johannesburg, South Africa, to the rest of the African continent. I'm Elvis Presnell. I'll be with you until 12 o'clock. As you know, we're also streaming live on YouTube with the entire show available on our YouTube channel. Today, we're asking you, in fact, we're focusing on the TRC, which marks 20 years since the first public hearings of South Africa's Truth and Reconciliation Commission. And we're asking you that question. Do you think there's a need for a second TRC? That is the question we pose to you. Do you think there's a need for a second TRC? You can let us know what's on your mind on the Twitter handle at SABC Newsroom, as well as on the Facebook page. That's the question. But first, before we get any further, let's take a look at all your news headlines. President Jacob Zuma leads a high-level government delegation for a round of talks relating to the Southern African Customs Union. Bodies of the victims of the weekend bus crash in which ANC volunteers were involved are currently being transported from Bloemfontein to Germiston Mortuary. And emergency rescue personnel in Ecuador rejoice after saving two survivors from rubble caused by a massive earthquake that left over 410 people dead. Now, those are all your headlines, but before we get to the news, let's find out from Kendall. Mark Famate, what's happening on the sports front? Very good morning once again, Kendall.
Elvis, thank you very much, and a good morning to you at home as well. This is what we've got for you in the sports today.
But the laureate World Sportsman of the Year is Novak Djokovic.
The world of tennis celebrated as Novak Djokovic and Serena Williams named the Sportsman and Sportswoman of the Year at the annual Laureate World Sports Awards.
And the Swiss stars got it. Who wins it?
And South Africa's wheelchair marathon ace, Wernst van Dijk, beaten into second place by Swiss Marcel Hug for the second time in a row at the Boston Marathon. All this as former Pakistan captain Inzamam Ul Haq gets the nod to take over as his country's chief selector. That is what we've got for you in the sports at about 11:30 or so. We'll also be bringing you a short interview with Clarence, the brand new 200-meter senior men's champion from South Africa. A little later on, but now back to Elvis.
Thank you, Kendall. Top story this hour. The bodies of the 10 victims of the weekend bus crash in the Free State are currently being transported to the Germiston Mortuary. The bodies left Bloemfontein this morning. The victims were returning to Gauteng after attending the ANC local election manifesto launch in Port Elizabeth the past weekend. Meanwhile, police say the two bus drivers will be charged with culpable homicide after they allegedly changed seats while the vehicle was in motion.
Naledi Sithole was supposed to celebrate his 10th birthday, but instead, he's mourning the death of his mother, Gugu Sithole. She was one of the ANC volunteers who died in a bus crash in the early hours of Sunday.
We have mixed emotions. It's more of, if only she didn't go, what went wrong?
Sithole died together with 10 others when the bus they were traveling in crashed between Windberg and Venterberg in the Free State. The Gauteng ANC visited six of the families.
We are devastated by this loss, and we wish we could have done things differently. These comrades who are departed are our volunteers.
For these survivors, though, it was a narrow escape. They were sleeping, but only to wake up on the side of the road. Those who witnessed the crash alleged that the drivers were trying to swap seats while the bus was in motion.
While we were traveling, we saw the two drivers exchanging seats just a few seconds before the accident. Then we later found ourselves lying on the side of the road.
An investigation is underway to determine the cause of the accident, while the bus company has also launched its own investigation. Ndlandlatlani, SABC News.
Update on that story is that the assistant driver or the second driver indicated that he tried to help or assist the driver that was falling asleep at the point in time when the bus crashed. But we'll keep you updated on that story. So stay tuned here on your favorite channel, 404, your favorite show, Newsroom. A high-level government delegation led by the President Jacob Zuma has arrived in Namibia for a round of talks relating to the Southern African Customs Union. The President held talks on the issue with Botswana's President Ian Khama yesterday. The Customs Union is aimed at improving trade and investment among member states.
President Jacob Zuma making a stopover in Botswana en route to Namibia. He is on a whirlwind tour to all SACU member states. There is consensus that this 100-year-old body needs a review to ensure that it benefits its members, the region and the continent. The meetings seek cooperation within custom union members.
We now have an opportunity to review the SACU so that we have a SACU we want. The SACU we will that will work for us. So President Zuma is on a listening mission so that when we finally have a SACU summit, we would all have listened to all our leadership.
But there is concern over payments of value-added tax on both sides of the border. Businessman Mkulusi Enoch owns a company which specializes in building warehouses and porter structures. He sources all his goods from South Africa.
You will find that they charge me 14% from that side. For example, for a 1 million goods, which is more than 114,000, it's around 114,000. So it takes about 3 months to claim that, and it kills the cash flow.
But according to SACU agreements, double taxation is not allowed.
I think it's largely a question of getting that information out, particularly to smaller traders, because you shouldn't have to pay value-added tax twice. You pay it once, not in more than one country.
The presidency says the visit to member state Lesotho will be decided in due course, but the outcome of the interactions will be made available after the Swaziland visit. Tsholofelo Mathibedi, SABC News, Gaborone, Botswana.
The African National Congress in the Northwest has thrown its weight behind President Jacob Zuma. It says calls made by the opposition and certain individuals are part of a concerted effort to cause harm and pandemonium in the country. The Provincial Executive Committee convened a joint meeting in Mahikeng with the party leagues to reflect on the Constitutional Court ruling on Nkandla.
The ANC in the Northwest says forces are behind the calls for President Zuma to step down.
We say they are free to express their view. They are part of the society we live under. But this won't deviate us from following the communication protocol of the ANC as understood by the duly elected leadership of the ANC.
The PAC maintains that the president has humbled himself before the nation, and his apology must be accepted.
Where can we get such a humble leader who is a president who is not arrogant and who takes society into confidence and say, I accept that A is human, I made mistakes, and I'm taking into my confidence as a president of the republic.
The party says it is now going to concentrate its energies on the forthcoming local government elections. Sello Tatai, SABC News, Mahikeng.
Finance Minister Pravin Gordhan says that efforts to market the South African economy are yielding positive results. The minister is in the United States to try and reassure rating agencies not to downgrade South Africa's credit status. Minister Gordhan says international investors are buying South African bonds, a move which suggests that there's improved confidence in the local economy. Securities exchange figures show that foreign investors bought a net 30 billion rands worth of South African bonds in 2016, compared with 10 billion rand in the same period last year. Back home, Algoa Bay in the Eastern Cape has been officially launched as the bottlenose dolphin capital of the world. Thousands of the dolphins inhabit the bay, and it's only fitting that the city has the bragging rights.
Scientific research conducted in the 1990s by the Center for Dolphin Studies in South Africa shows that approximately 20,000 bottlenose dolphins were making use of Algoa Bay. Today, that number has increased, and the estimated population of the bay is close to 30,000 individuals. This number surpasses other areas in the world.
90% of our cruises, and I'm talking over the last 20 years, we see numbers in between 50 and about 600 individuals, which is quite astounding. I've looked at other places around the world, other models, and nowhere else does anyone see Indo-Pacific bottlenose dolphins as many as we do.
In addition to being named the dolphin capital of the world, a dolphin festival will be held in the city each year to celebrate the international popularity of the species.
This is extremely exciting for Nelson Mandela Bay as well as our Algoa Bay. It is always wonderful to discover new experiences and something special about our destination. This is truly unique to us. It will give us definitely something different to sell and showcase about our wonderful Algoa Bay.
Bottlenose dolphins appeal to people worldwide. The permanent smiles on their faces and the interactions they have with people make them an incredible attraction in their natural environment. Janine Lee, SABC News, Port Elizabeth.
The deepening hunger crisis in Malawi is threatening the survival of children.
And also it is the life-threatening part of malnutrition.
Malawi is facing its worst food crisis in 9 years.
Mugabe is the world's oldest sitting head of state, ahead of Queen Elizabeth of Britain.
The veteran leader seeks to temporarily forget his party's problems and instead focus on his legacy.
But he shows no sign of slowing down or stepping down from power after 36 years in office.
Welcome back. A war has erupted between rival gangs in Eastern Paarl in the Western Cape. Parents say they fear for their children's lives. After a recent period of calm, fighting has flared up once again. Parliament's Police Portfolio Committee Chair Francois Beekman visited the area to help map a way forward. But it seems the crux of the problem is that the community is being held hostage by children.
It's a suburb not unlike many others on the South African landscape. It bears all the trademarks of underprivileged, low-income communities. Unemployment is high. Substance abuse is growing. There are few to no extramural activities for the kids. Gangsterism has started to rear its ugly head again. It's become a rather attractive option to boys, some as young as 12 years old.
It's quite important that we address the issue of youth gangsterism and the issues of drugs in the area. Before July 2015, Paarl East was relatively calm in terms of that, but it's a huge concern for us that these developments have happened here, and it must be addressed by the community and by the police.
What exactly sparks the fighting? This is not clear.
In ons plek hulle ja onder is eintlik leef ons almal in gevaar en hyso hoe hulle klippe gooi en ons plekke word beskadig deur klippe gooi, mense se ruite word uitgegooi. Die is nie 'n geweldige geweld wat hyso plaasvind hyso.
But it's clear that their living conditions have everything to do with their life choices.
Ons is mos rastas sien maar
ons pla mos hierdie mense en so nie. Maar as die eiers hierdie stasie toe loop, dan word hulle ook geroep. Want die gangsters leidtikies en goed wat tik gebruik en drugs. Maar alles gaat oor week, mevrouw. Allemaal van ons het week nodig, sien maar. Soos hulle ook, hulle sal even niet klip gooi nie. Hulle is ook honger.
The SAPS in the area say they are working with the community. Plans are in the pipeline to address the problem. But long-term plans are needed to address the social conditions that drive these children to self-destructive behavior. Community leaders understand that the problems cannot be left at the door of the SAPS alone.
I would like to see that we as the community stand up and work together. Because we know, some of the community people knows what is the problem and who is the problem in the community. So if we stand together, we can do more.
While filming, we were alerted to a group of young boys making their way to one of the local schools. They were apparently on their way to stir trouble at a school attended by their rivals. Residents easily identified the ringleaders, but many adults are too afraid to speak on camera. They fear reprisals from children who are often operating with the support of their parents.
Eindelik hang het van ons ouers af om ons kinders uit daai klipgooiery uit te gaan haal en vir hulle 'n les op verstaan nie in is regtig waar is erg.
Beekman agrees.
The main issue is that it's a social problem. We need the involvement of parents, of schools. Schools are very vital in that regard, and of course sporting communities, civic associations, the neighborhood watches, community police forums, street committees, they must all take part in dealing with this issue.
Local police are still in the planning phase of possible interventions, but because the bulk of these young boys are school dropouts, the Department of Social Development will have to join the fray. The municipality will also be roped in to create activities and implement special programs for the children in this area. Abra Barbia, SABC News, Paul East.
Well, even a dog with glasses on, that's gangster. Now, the building of an Islamic place of worship in Valhalla in Centurion in Gauteng has evoked strong, divisive reactions from the residents. Now, they've protested against the erection of the mosque, saying the right procedures were not followed. More than 3,000 residents have signed a petition opposing the mosque. Now, this regardless of the city of Tshwane approving the mosque construction. The mayor of Tshwane, Kosiento Ramakgopa, says that the right procedures were followed.
This is nothing unique. We have already donated about 148 sites to different church denominations across the length and breadth of the city. And part of that process requires that there must be public consultations. And once public consultation is concluded, then it gets to be submitted to council for consideration. And in all of these applications, the response has been positive. Remember that what we look at is whether the site is available, one. Secondly, is that what is the demographics of the area. And the third one is that we want to ensure that the social cohesion, that people of all religious convictions must have places of worship so that we are able to improve the quality of lives in these residential areas. So other people are in denial about the demographic changes. This is a constitutionally entrenched right. We are going to defend that the right of people to worship, including Muslims. There's nothing unique about Muslims. They are part of the broad tapestry of races, ethnic groups that we find in the city of Tshwane, and they will be found in Valhalla, they will be found in all places in the city of Tshwane. We are going to protect their right.
But then, Mayor, they are saying that they were not properly consulted, there were no public participation processes in this whole matter, and yet you're saying that public participation has actually taken place.
Oh, the public participation was the most fierce and robust. Even people nearly came into physical blows. So it has taken place, we have records of that. It was also confirmed in council. The ward councillors submitted their views also. So that has happened. So that's the first lie. The first lie is that there was no public participation. I'm sure we can show you records, we can give you dates. The second one is that people ostensibly raises issues of noise pollution, when in fact the Muslim community has said we have modernized, they've moved with the times. There are not going to be loud hailers calling for people to prayer. There will be transmitters in individual houses. So ostensibly it's about the noise, but we know that the underlying objection is about the changes that we are seeing in this area. And as a city of Tshwane, we are prepared to defend the rights of everyone and ensure that we build a non-racial society, a society that is not based on any form of prejudice, that everyone, including Muslims, have brought the places of worship, and that's going to happen. I'm more than confident that come a year's time, a mosque will be rising from here, and the people of Valala will be very happy.
Now, those opposed to the erection of the mosque went as far as signing a petition. So I want to know, had they perhaps met with the city of Tshwane to voice their concerns?
No. You don't substitute public participation through petitions. You go into a meeting, state what your views are, articulate them, allow the other side to also respond.
So are you saying that they actually went to the public meeting?
Well, I wouldn't know what is the register of the public meeting, but we have called a public meeting well attended. Don't substitute that process and come clandestinely, submit a petition to me. Raise your issue in front of the public, and your issue, your views will be encountered there, and I'm sure that we'll find a way of resolving it. As far as we are concerned, that process is closed. That's what under the bridge, the mosque is coming up. They must live with that reality. This is what the transformation is about, that the demographics have changed. One of the issues that is coming up is that schools in this area were of a particular language medium of instruction. We are going to insist to the MEC that we must introduce other languages, not to the demise of what languages that exist there, because the demographics has changed. Go to the nearest school there. The majority of kids, they are black. They are Africans. So it's important that we are able to accommodate everyone. These things of racial enclave is the things of the past. It's not going to be found in the city of Tshwane for as long as the ANC is.
So are you saying that they actually opposed to transformation? Is that what you're saying?
Yes, that's a big agenda. It's so obvious. It's glaringly obvious that they're opposed to transformation. Tomorrow will come and want to introduce something new, that we must have a soccer field. People will oppose to it, that say it must be a rugby field, it must be a cricket oval. It's not going to happen. We're going to accommodate everyone. So we didn't say churches must go away. We've got a number of churches in this area. There's more than 200 Muslim families in this area. They need a place to worship, and that place is the grounds where we are standing, and then we have already given them the rights to do that. So if someone comes lament about the process, I'm sure they can pursue other means. As far as the city is gone, this is closed. I've insisted on the Muslim community. Now we want to see the mosque coming up, and I'll be the first one to come and open the mosque.
Well, according to the mayor, the mosque will be up. Now, tempers are boiling in Centurion in Pretoria as a result of that decision to build an Islamic place of worship there. Earlier, our SABC News team talked to the representatives from the opposing sides. The Muslim community says allegations that the process of erecting the mosque was not followed is untrue. About 3,000 Valhalla residents are unhappy with the construction of a mosque.
First of all, I think you need to take into account that right from the beginning, the normal process is to notify a community with notifications on the ground itself that the ground will be changing ownership and those, especially when it comes to council property. That wasn't done. Number two, in that very first process, the ward councillor wasn't informed, and the ward committee wasn't informed, which is part of the public participation process as required by the Public Participation Act.
So are you saying the ward committee was not involved? And you do sit in the ward committee meetings, don't you?
That is correct. They were never informed of this whole process. So that started the whole premise off wrong. We actually had 2 days notification where a third of the population of Valhalla within 2 days objected to this mosque. So therefore it shows that due process wasn't followed. If due process had been followed and it had gone through the right procedures, we wouldn't have had this problem. I don't blame the Muslim community for trying to get their church. I do blame council for not following due process.
Let's get their view. I see you disagreeing with him when he says proper procedures were not followed.
Richard is not being honest. The mayor of Tshwane put it very clearly that all due processes were followed.
24th of August 2014, I attended a public meeting with the community, residents of Valhalla, even the objectors were there. For the record, the ward councillor...
I'm sorry, that's a lie.
Can I please finish my point?
Let him say his side of the story. I am going to come back to you.
24th of August 2014, the DA ward councillor was in the meeting. She objected to the proposed mosque. There was a lot of shouting, a lot of screaming. Two other public meetings were held. If the community wasn't informed, why did your ward councillor and why did the residents of Valhalla come to the meeting? Point number one. Secondly, let me come to the core problem here. Yes, people have a right to object. The mayor said it this morning. The land has been allocated. If people feel that the right processes were not followed, we have law and order in South Africa. You're welcome to take it to a court of law. What we are seeing in Valhalla, very sadly, is racism and Islamophobia. We are seeing people, part of the objection group, threatening to throw pig's heads at the mosque, threatening violence, inciting violence.
But who are those? Do you personally know
those people? We have their names, we have their phone numbers, and we are going to take them to the Equality Court and the Human Rights Commission. And I want Richard to publicly condemn his fellow citizens who are inciting violence. We saw placards last week where they were demonstrating ISIS, Peres, Valhalla. What has our religion got to do with ISIS? The word Boko Haram has been thrown around. The misinformation that we are seeing here is very, very sad.
Well, let me give Richard time to respond.
Okay. First of all, it's a lie that there was a public process. When it came to the meeting that he's talking about, the public participation, me as the objector, because my name was the one that was put forward as the as representing the objectors, I wasn't informed. The councillor wasn't informed. That's after two processes. Wait, now it's my turn. And for him to say that this is a racist action, that's racist in itself. You understand? To brush the whole of the community with this racist brush. There's a few individuals, just like I'm sure there is. Yes, ISIS forms part of the Muslim community as well, because they do say that. They do say they are from Islam. So they are a small minority within Islam that is also racist. So yes, within every community, you're going to get a few racists. It's a given. However, this process, why I was involved in this process, was because the community was never consulted. We have a Public Participation Act that says that a community must be consulted. I sat in a petitions meeting where the official said to my face, "We don't care what the Valhalla residents think. This thing is going through." Then the mayor on Tuesday himself said, "We will put a mosque in every single area in Tshwane, and we don't care. If you don't like it, move out."
Palesa, there are 8 churches in this particular area. There's a community of about 250 plus Muslim families here. We have a right to a mosque. Our constitution guarantees.
Are you saying 250?
That's debatable.
Because Mr. Botha earlier on was saying 40.
Now, Mr. Botha will live in his own world. Mr. Botha has agreed that part of his objecting group are racist. Thank you for making the admission. That is the core of the problem. We are dealing here with a bunch of racists who are against transformation.
Let me just get here, gentlemen, because we're not going to go anywhere if we do not cooperate. Are those not serious allegations?
I am prepared to back up that allegation in the South African Human Rights Commission or the Equality Court. We have it on Facebook, we have it on Twitter, where people are saying, "We will come and throw pig's head, we'll stop the Muslim community." The derogatory words are being used as part of the objections group. Be it as it may.
And I've got people that have been threatened by people by telephone that have been threatened that they will be taken out.
Let me just come here once again. Those that had placards that were written ISIS, yes. Do you know those? Because apparently they're also objectors to the whole issue. Do you perhaps know those people?
I don't know them personally. Just remember, there's over 3,000 people that put their name to the petition. I don't know those 3,000 people personally.
But what do you have to say as part of the objectors regarding the incitement of violence?
Well, you see, the thing is that this has heated up to a stage where, look, I disagree with any statements made about pig heads or anything like that. I disagree with any of those statements. However, there have been phone calls made which I was informed by the ward councillor of this council, where she was threatened if she continued with her stance.
The ward councillor is open welcome to open criminal charges against anyone. Violence will not be tolerated. We have a right to a mosque. People can stand on their heads, they can threaten us with violence. This mosque will come up. The mayor said it this morning. This mosque will come up whether people like it or not.
This is apartheid because you're not listening to the community. This is
a handful of people.
Excuse me. Excuse me. A third of the community within 2 days.
You know what? Let me tell you now.
A third of the community. You represent less than 1%.
There's a pastor from a local mosque. He came here to come and support the mosque. The Jewish community has come forward to support the mosque. You are scared. What you are promoting is Islamophobia. You relate our religion
I'm
to ISIS.
I'm promoting democratic process.
Democratic when you object to a mosque.
I'm promoting.
You're right. You're demoting our religion. You said it now. You've admitted you're demoting our religion.
I'm promoting democratic process. That's it.
Here.
I'm saying, why did the mayor hand over the property before the lapse of the appeal period?
If you think
why
is wrong, take him to court.
You know what?
And we will see you in court.
I think that this is politically motivated. I think that this is politically motivated. And
why do you believe it's politically motivated?
Are you a member of the ACDP or Freedom Front?
No.
Which party do you support?
No, it's not about which party. No, it's very much irrelevant in this regard. Gentlemen, remember that
the ACDP and the Freedom Front voted against.
I can't speak for the ACDP or the Freedom Front.
Gentlemen, let's just get this back to order. Let us just get back to this to order. Gentlemen,
that was requested. To represent the
Okay, all right.
Population.
Now that we've just spoken to the mayor of Tshwane, who said that the processes were followed, the erection of the mosque is just going to continue as expected. Are you going to explore other avenues, perhaps?
Look, I am following the appeals process at the moment, which only elapses on the 28th. Now, the mayor has already handed over the piece of ground, even although Municipal Systems Act states that there's an appeal period of 21 working days after a decision is made by council. I will follow that process on behalf of the community. I will also approach a court of law on behalf of the community, and if it needs to go to the Constitutional Court, so be it, because I think this is an issue that needs to be resolved. I think this is unhealthy. I seriously think this is unhealthy for South Africa as a whole. I think we need to get to a stage where we understand what our democracy is about and where we understand the future of our democracy.
Now, one other issue that you mentioned to me earlier on was the fact that there is going to be noise as they pray 5 times a day. And I spoke to Mr. Abramji earlier on, who said that with the latest technology innovation, there is not going to be any noise.
You see, I appreciate that. And that does allay some of the fears that were raised by the community. However, when the mayor stood up on Tuesday, he said, yes, in this call to prayer, that is the way they practice their religion, and we will support it 100%. So it looks as if the problem isn't here. It would appear that the problem's coming from council more than anything else. So maybe we're looking at the wrong space.
And how do you have to respond? But because it looks like the message never got to ordinary people on the ground, because their fear was noise.
The mayor said it again this morning. We've agreed, the community has agreed, and members of the community, the leadership are here today, that we will have transmitters in the homes of people so that the call of prayer does not disturb anyone. We are a very tolerant religion. There are mosques throughout the world, right? A mosque is not a place where hatred is being promoted. A mosque is a place for peace. We have a right to pray 5 times a day. Richard uses the argument that Laudium in Erasmus is a few kilometers away. There are 8 churches in Valhalla. This is a predominantly, before the first dawn of democracy, it was only a white area. The Muslim community has moved in here. The African community has moved in here. No, I'm not finished. You had your chance. And what we need to do is to really stand up for what is right. Our constitution, which is a great constitution, promotes freedom of religion. My religion has a right to freedom. To relate my religion to ISIS is an insult. To relate it to Boko Haram is an insult. And I'm happy that Richard has agreed that many of his supporters are racist.
Did you really say that they are racist within those that are objecting?
I did not say many. I did not say anything. I said within every community, including the Muslim community, there is probably racist.
Are there racist in the group that are opposed to the erection of
the mosque? Not that I know personally.
And now
I just want to ask another question. Some of the groups that objected as well were not just white Afrikaner. I know that's the best way to create a racist impression over here. Some of them were from the previously residents of Erasmus and Laudium as well. okay, they Hindus, whites as well, but also there's black members of our community that have said they like the culture of our community and they're worried because of what they saw happen in Laudium and Erasmia, where they felt the need to leave those areas because they felt that they were being forced out of those areas. Now, I'm not saying this. I'm saying this is what I'm hearing from the community. So maybe the whole process, because it was flawed, it never gave an opportunity for people to actually communicate with each other, to actually have those public participations. It was a knee-jerk reaction to this as being forced through. And now this started its trend.
And you see, quickly, we've got to conclude it right there, very much quickly.
There were three public processes, public meetings were held. Point number two, Valala is not Orania. We cannot live in enclaves. This is a multicultural, a multifaceted community, and we are allowed to our having our mosque. Nothing will stop this mosque from coming up. We will fight this matter if we have to the Constitutional Court. But I think what we need to do is, like the mayor said last week, we have to pray for the likes of people like Richard. We have to educate them because they are misinformed. Islamophobia must come to an end. We as a community are sick and tired of people throwing the race card and inciting violence. We will fight them and we will make sure that this mosque comes up.
Welcome back. Now, just to come back from that heated discussion, a little bit of sports to ease your mind. Now, top tennis players Novak Djokovic and Serena Williams were named the Sportsman and Sportswoman of the Year at the annual Laureus World Sports Awards in Berlin, Germany. The awards honor the greatest sporting achievements by individuals and teams throughout the year.
The who's who of the sporting world gathered in Berlin to celebrate those who achieved excellence in their game in 2015. Djokovic and Williams were the cream of the crop.
But the Laureus World Sportsman of the Year is Novak Djokovic.
The Serbian world number one reached all four Grand Slam singles finals last year. He won three. His only loss coming at the French Open to Stanislas Wawrinka.
I dedicate this award to two people that have inspired me not only tonight but throughout their lives and careers in so many different ways, and I want to thank them for the legacy. I want to thank them for their wisdom and for blessing us with the wonderful words that we are all going to follow, at least I will. Mr. Niki Lauda and Mr. Jochen Cruyff.
Serena Williams. In a remarkable year, Serena won the Australian, French and Wimbledon titles, giving her all four Grand Slam titles at the same time.
Williams, who did not attend the event, also won three of the four Grand Slam women's singles titles last year and was named the WTA's Player of the Year for the seventh time. Brazil's Paralympic swimmer Daniel Dias was named Sportsperson of the Year with a Disability. This after he bagged seven gold medals at last year's IPC Swimming World Championships in Glasgow, Scotland. Rugby World Cup winning New Zealand took the Team of the Year accolade. The All Blacks became the first team ever to win back-to-back World Cups when they beat Australia in the final at Twickenham.
It was a heap of hard work, and you know, not just from players but from management that set out to get on that path, and to achieve it in October last year was pretty special.
All Black fly half Dan Carter won the Comeback of the Year award. Carter was named Man of the Match in the final in England after missing the 2011 edition due to injury. After victory at both the Masters and US Open last year, US golfer Jordan Spieth was rewarded with the Breakthrough of the Year award. And three-time Formula One world champion Niki Lauda received a Lifetime Achievement Award at the ceremony, while a special Spirit of Sport Award was given posthumously to Dutch soccer legend Johan Cruyff, who passed away 3 weeks ago. His son Jordi received the award on his behalf. Liesel Zankel, SABC News.
And Switzerland's Marcel Hug denied South African Ernst van Dijk a record 11th title when he beat van Dijk by 1 second to win the 2016 Boston Marathon. This was Hug's second consecutive men's wheelchair title in Boston, after edging van Dijk last year as well. Hug crossed the finish line in a time of 1 hour, 24 minutes and 1 second.
Race course, Al. Having surrendered his title to Marcelo Hug of Switzerland last year, Ernst van Dijk went into this year's Boston Marathon looking to cement his legacy in the event. 2 years ago, van Dijk made wheelchair racing history when he became the first athlete to win 10 Boston Marathon titles. It was always going to be a big ask for Van Dijk, with the six former winners taking part in this year's race. The South African, however, took the early lead with the chasing pack hot on his heels. It was not long, though, before Hook overtook the 2012 London Olympic silver medalist. In the end, the Swiss outsprinted both Van Dijk and Australian Kite Finley to claim his second consecutive Boston crown, while the South African edged Finley by inches to finish second.
Ernst, how did it go for you? That was just a thrilling finish. Three men abreast going down Boylston.
Yeah, you know, there was so much happening in the race. Like, in the beginning, I had a bit of a gap, and then another guy pulled about 20 guys back to me. And then Marcel made a big jump, and Kurt went with him. It dropped me every time we hit a hill, and every time I had to fight back. So to come up second, this is the start of the wheelchair majors, and this is the way to start it.
Well, we've got one winner today, but three great champions coming across the line.
Meanwhile, in the women and men's able-bodied athletes, Ethiopian Atsedi Beisa and Lemi Hali were both crowned 2016 Boston Marathon champions. Joseph Mohali, SABC News.
And boxing fans are in for a treat later this month when four world title fights will be held at one tournament. The showcase takes place in Polokwane on the 29th of April.
Tonight it was announced that IBO World Heavyweight Champion Seko Molebetsi will defend his title against Mexican Jesus Jorrello on a night which will see four world title fights in Polokwane on the 29th of April. In another fight, Gideon Buthelezi will defend his IBO Junior Bantamweight title against Namibia's Diego Potato. Malcolm Clarkson and Mexican Leonilo Miranda will battle it out for the vacant WBA Junior Lightweight title. And lastly, the last world title fight on the night will see Bongani Silila take on Namibia's Jafet Utoni for the vacant WBO Junior Flyweight title.
It has never happened in the history of boxing in South Africa where four prominent titles will put at stake in one night. This is what is needed in the country so that we can say boxing is back. This is what motivates other people to join the forces in the sports of boxing.
The two defending world champions are confident of retaining their titles.
I'm very ready. I've been training ever since from my last fight in December. So, but then only two months back I started camping.
Well, the Mexican, they're too strong and they're coming forward. Yeah. Anything can happen, but I know one thing, I'm going to defend my title by knockout. I don't know where I'm going.
This boxing extravaganza will be brought to you by SABC Sport.
Our involvement as the SABC really is to bring the sport to the people. We want to revive the sporting code, boxing sporting code. So we're going to be broadcasting these fights on all our radio stations and our TV platforms.
On the undercard, there will also be a provincial junior welterweight, junior featherweight, and a bantamweight clash.
Now, South Africa finished fourth overall at this year's opening World Cup rowing event in Varese, Italy. It was the first proper warm-up event for the Olympic Games in Rio. They beat countries such as the United States and Great Britain as they collected two gold and two bronze medals.
I think it's always good to come out on top. Not all the big guys are here this weekend necessarily, but we've had a lot of time to sort of first race back in the double for the last season and really got to work on some good stuff, the stuff we've been doing in the training to see how it comes into the racing, so really good for us. Happy with how we started.
We still have internal selection, so even though we've qualified the boat, the athletes as us still has to qualify within our country selection, so we still have a lot to do to make sure that we're in the boat, but as Chris said, this is a good first step.
Amongst us we have an attitude of excellence and going for gold, so we're driving each other. I mean, not only is it Ursula and I and the other lightweights back home, but I mean the heavyweight women, the lightweight men, heavyweight men, we're all racing against each other every single day during the week. So we have this, we want to be the best in the squad, and I think it's obviously you can see at this World Cup with so many of our boats excelling.
Now for a little bit of British football, with Tottenham Hotspur's Harry Kane and Dele Alli scored a brace each to earn the team a 4-0 victory at Stoke City. The visitors took full advantage of log leaders Leicester City's 2-2 home draw with West Ham United and closed the gap to 5 points with four matches remaining.
Dembele. Back to Kane.
Love to shoot from this sort of area and shoot like that. It's another masterpiece from Harry Kane.
Better of him.
Well, that's the best we've seen from Stoke so far. Christian Eriksen, it's opened up for him. Oh, he's rattled the bar and he really should have scored. It's a wonderful ball from Christian Eriksen. And Ali makes no mistake. And Spurs have the second goal that they were craving. Pochettino was craving. Is Pat Lamela's offside, is he? But the flag has stayed down. And he gives the goal for Kane. And it is 3-0. Eriksen, don't rule out a fourth for Tottenham. Well, there you are. Right on cue. Two for Dele Alli now.
Now, history will be made tonight with the first CAF Champions League midweek fixtures scheduled across the continent. Games are also scheduled for Wednesday as the African football body reacts to pressure from some national associations wanting more weekends reserved for domestic fare. The aggregate winner in the round of fixtures will proceed to the group stages of the Champions League, while the loser will be relegated to the Confederation Cup. Now, 18-year-old Clarence Munyai beat all comers to the tape in the men's senior 200-meter sprint at the South African Senior Championships in Stellenbosch. This he did in a time of 20.74 seconds over the weekend. He spoke to Simon Burke last night on Sports Live.
I am very happy about Stellenbosch, but I'm not happy about the time, but I'm happy that I won the title.
But we're going to just clarify things, because you say you're not happy with the time. You've already qualified for the Olympic standard twice this year. Is that correct?
Yes, I've qualified for the Olympics twice. One was in Germiston, and then the other one was in UJ at Johannesburg.
And currently, if I'm not mistaken, the one in Germiston, that is actually the 11th fastest time in the world as it stands this year.
Yes, it is the 11th fastest time in seniors this year, and I don't know what to say because I'm still a junior athlete, but I'm very happy.
Yeah, well, we're going to get to that right now. What the big question we want to know from you, Clarence, is Rio in your sights at the moment? Is it a possibility? We know this probably came all a little bit too soon for you, but are you up to the challenge? Will you be able to get to the Olympics?
Well, if I do get selected for the Olympics, the main challenge will be trying to make the final, because there will be the likes of Usain Bolt and Anaso Jobodwana, the bronze medalists from last year, but that will be a challenge when I get there.
So can we put it down there that you are going to Rio?
That's if SASCOC do select me, but we have to wait for SASCOC.
Right, so that's the only thing standing in your way. Now let's get back to your age. You're still only in grade 11. And you're hitting these global standards and you're 18 years of age. How are you coping with all of this?
Well, like, I am not taking it like into head that much. I still have to focus on school because I still have to finish. And then after I finish, that's when I'll try to think about being a professional. But at this time, I still have to balance school and athletics.
So Rio is a possibility, depending on what SASCOC say. However, one thing that is a certainty is you are going to go to Poland in July for the IAAF Under-20s, if I'm not mistaken.
Yes, I am going to go to the IAAF World Under-20 in Poland, which is in July.
And how do you think at this moment in time, where you see how your career has progressed so far, how do you think the Under-20s is going to work out for you? Is this a stepping stone, or is this what you've been preparing for and building up to?
Well, we have been preparing for the 20s since last year, which it is the main goal. And I would like to come back with a medal, because I don't just want to go there and be like a person who fills up the lanes. I want to come back with a medal.
But tell us about your training partner, because you got quite a good relationship going at the Tuck Sport High School with Gift Leotlela.
Well, Gift Leotlela is like one of my best friends at school. We train together every single day. Some people think we're rivals, but I don't see him as a rival. I see him as a friend, because we push each other. He ran a second fastest time any youth has ever run 100 meters last year, which was 10:20, and then it just motivated us to try and do what he did.
Well, there you have it. Clarence Munyai, the brand new 200-meter South African sprint champion. Seems like we're going to have more and more of those as time goes towards Olympics. You've been watching Newsroom. My name is Kendall Makamati. I'll be back with Elvis Presley tomorrow. Until then, bye-bye. Tonight in an